Go, Lee.
The Church of What's Happening Now is presented by On It. This show is brought to you by MeUndies. MeUndies are the perfect gift for you and your Valentine's this holiday, and they come in limited edition prints, and even better, for a limited time, our listeners can get a 20% discount off of their first order, and shipping is always free in the U.S. and Canada. You have to go to MeUndies.com/Joey. That's MeUndies.com/Joey. The show is also brought to you by ZipRecruiter. To find candidates in any city, industry, nationwide, post once at ZipRecruiter. Right now, our listeners can go to ZipRecruiter and post for free when you go to ZipRecruiter.com/church. That's ZipRecruiter.com/church.
Kick that muley. It's Monday, bitches. Oh, shit. Oh, shit. Monday, January 23rd, the Church of What's Happening Now. You're here, Lee Syatt, Ralphie May, and your Uncle Joey Diaz. Oh, shit. Kick it, Lee. Blow those fucking speakers. Oh, shit. Here we go, cocksuckers. Steal grandma's volumes. We're going. What's happening, you bad motherfuckers? Monday. It's Tuesday by the time you listen. Hope you're having a great fucking day. Uncle Joey, Ralphie May.
Hey, everybody.
Before we get the podcast started, I got to apologize for Wednesday night. Mike Kessler was on here. I love him to death and everything. He's my uncle. He was at my wedding. I love him to death, but Jesus fucking Christ. Before he came on the podcast, his retarded fucking daughter told him not to use his last name. There's something going on. She's suing somebody for poisoning her, so she's seeing fucking DEA agents in front of her house. This poor kid was always fucking retarded, okay? She worked at a restaurant. She was dating a dude for 9 years. All of a sudden, one day she comes home, and she's fucking a lesbian. Just like that. No fucking training camp. No nothing. She just becomes a fucking lesbian right there. You know there's a fucking problem right there. I don't say nothing. I keep it to myself, okay? She gets a dog with this ugly fucking lesbo. They get a house. Then the lesbo beats her up. Domestic violence. Who the fuck? Because she's a fucking nut. Then she went back to Dick. Then back to... She's worse than Ellen's old wife. Remember the chick?
Oh, yeah.
And Donnie Brasco? And yeah. Then she went and had two kids, and now nothing. No more lesbian, no more LGBTQ community. That's how quick these motherfuckers change in LA.
They go from LGBT to BLT.
Yeah, from the BLT. So now he comes on the show, and every question I ask him, he says he thinks it's like the Godfather 2. Like he's under questioning by Congress. I did not remember that certain fucking thing.
Mr. Senator, you owe my client an apology.
When the fucking podcast ended, I launched into him. Then his fucking retarded wife calls me. What did you give Mike? He's 70 years old. Mike did heroin for 30 fucking years. A fucking edible is not going to put a dent. First of all, that guy's one of those guys. I love Mike. He's my uncle. But he's one of those guys that hasn't stopped since he got back from Vietnam. Do you know what that means? He's always got something in his pocket.
Yeah.
He may not be doing blow, but he may have fentanyl, that shit Michael Jackson drank. Or he may have Vicodins, or he may have, he's just one of those dudes since I've known him, or he might have weed, or he might, but he's always got, so like I told her, when she called me back again, then I go, listen, he's fine, he's going to be fine, he just ate fucking 200 milligrams, just let him sleep it off. She goes, he doesn't know where he is. I go, you know, God knows what's in this fucking system.
Yeah,
but I go, you were his wife for 30 years, and you're another fucking retard calling me at 2 in the morning. And I thought they were going to take him to the hospital.
I'm like, oh, my God. Hospital. What a pussy.
But no, he's fine. He woke up, and 2 days later, he called me, apologized, and he was staying at the Marriott because the retarded daughter, the older one, fucking kept hearing Martians and people at the
door. Oh, my God.
You know,
crazy.
Man, there's a thin line between mental health and, like, fucking, and you could see it. Like, I'm just fucking crazy and I do drugs.
Right.
But the mental health issues, they're coming. I feel them from time to time. Last night I went off at the Hindu at 7-Eleven because he wanted to charge me 10 cents for a fucking bag.
I'm in there every fucking day.
Oh, I'm in there every day. Fucker. And they always give me a bag. Last night, this particular fucking dot gave me, like, the evil eye and then charged me 10 cents. I fucking went off on him and I threw a dollar at him. I go, here's a dollar, you fuck. I'm family in the 7-Eleven. I've stopped burglaries in here. This is one of the only 7-Elevens in the country I don't shoplift. I give you the respect.
Wow.
I don't even shoplift. I've never shoplifted at the 7-Eleven. You don't shit in your backyard. They're right there. They're good people.
Yeah. I'm family at the 7-Eleven.
Yeah. It's not the ISIS 7-Eleven on Chandler and Laurel Canyon. I went in there today, dog. That's straight up ISIS.
That's ISIS is
I wouldn't eat that motherfucker because they're poisoning you. They're poisoning you with, like, that gas. They're trying shit out on you.
That hot dog will blow up.
Yeah, I don't fuck with that 7-Eleven. I had to drive my friend in there today. I was with that dude.
When the taquito is ticking, you know what I mean?
No, I hate that shit. So, yeah, I'm very sorry about the podcast last week, guys. You know, it was never my intention. I had to sit here and talk with myself with Lee, and he kept sitting there. He didn't know where he was. He was tapping on the table.
That is so
He was swallowing
overrated.
His nose. He was fucking doing everything to irritate the shit out of me. But anyway, now that's off my chest. How are you, cocksucker? It's a beautiful fucking Tuesday. Ralphie May, what up?
Hey, baby. It's so great to be here in part of the church. I love it. You got the new Pope, Coco Boom Boom Diaz. Where's the package?
Look at Lee. Lee's got a look on his face.
I got
look
Cardinal Lee Syatt, the only Jew.
Look at him.
I know. He's back.
He's well, what off do you think? Fuck.
Yeah, he's got the China eyes.
When you start me off with, I don't know, how whatever thousands of milligrams you gave me, like, it got to the point where the nice lady at the store that we go to told me I need to take a tolerance break. She told me. I've seen her so much that she's like,
which lady?
The blonde, the skinny one. She's very nice. I think her name is like Sky or
cute.
Oh, Sky.
With the black, she's blonde over black hair, real cute.
Yeah,
I think her a lot.
You know, everyone over there is great, but she's like, because I went in there and I even told you, I was like, I asked for something new, and she's like, well, you've tried everything. I was like, no, there has to be something. Like, knew that's more than 50 milligrams, and there's literally, like, I walked around the store three times, and there's nothing that you haven't given me, and there's nothing, there's nothing strong enough in weed stores now. Like, I have to poison myself with 2,000 milligrams to get anywhere near stoned anymore. Like, it's...
Isn't it great?
Yeah, no
you're
doubt.
Very fortunate.
Now you're bulletproof,
that's
Lee.
That's right, you're bulletproof. They can't fuck with you. They can't stop you.
What if one of those dirty Russian cocksuckers tried to put something in you? You'd be like, go fuck yourself with your truth, Sarah.
Yeah.
I'm fucking Lee,
I've been
the flying Jew Syatt.
That when ISIS comes, they're going to poison these people, and you're going to be the only one standing. Everybody else is going to be on the floor.
All these other Jews are going to be weak.
Puking and shit. You'll be in training.
We're strong.
Is that why you go to multiple stores? Like, is that... Like,
yes!
Is that just they don't know what you're doing?
We're doomsday preppers.
Well, Ralphie, you... Like, I've only heard stories about you. I think it's, like, from Ari and then from Joey about, like, you had... Like, before mason jars were cool, you had, like, a pint mason, like, a gallon mason jar of just weed on the table.
On the table?
On the table. I still got it.
Where was that place at? That was close to Chapico.
Yeah.
Off Pico, the first place you moved to when Sean Rouse was living with you.
Yeah.
He had a fucking container in the fucking middle.
It was a pound of weed.
It was fucking awesome.
It was huge. It was one of those big ass...
He would go to that place on Mondays and turn out their lights.
Turn out the lights.
3 ounces of this, 4 ounces. They would sit there and go, what the fuck are you doing with this?
I know. And the truth is that most of it, I gave it away.
People in the clubs would tell me, like the waiters, when I get there, the waiters would go, he showed up with these fucking Chiba chews.
Yeah. And I think it's just the coolest thing to do, you know? I mean, the first time my buddy Ari Shafir, of course, you know Ari, right? You know Ari Lee.
Absolutely, yeah.
Okay, Ari, first time he ever saw an ounce of weed, I handed it to him. Here, Ari, you're hilarious. I love you. Here, try this weed. You know? We were the first.
He couldn't believe it.
In comics, I mean, in 2003 or 2004, I was the first one start making some money and that was a stoner, you know? So it was like, fuck, we're all going. We're all partying, okay? We're all partying. Coco, take this. Try this. And you know what? Joey is a guy that will eat a girl's pussy while melting a coke rock on her clit, and then reach into her pocketbook and get hundreds, okay? All right? And mad that he only pulls out ones and fives, okay? All right? He's mad till he gets that hundred. Then oh, she came. I'm out of here, right? But when it came to taking weed from me, I had to force it to him. You had to force it to him. You did not... Your pride, you're like, I can buy my own weed. I know you can, but here, take this.
Oh, you give me that Matt's OG. This. That oh my fucking God. Matt's OG. I missed that shit.
Me too, man. 35%. Damn, that was good.
I really missed that fucking reefer. That was I good saw him a few that. Months ago, man.
Yeah? He at married that girl. Pier.
Yeah, he had long hair, and he was doing his thing. You know, yeah. I said he closed it down. You know, it's amazing how those... He was... When Cushmart opened... The word on the street from a lot of people, Cushmart at one time were making 25 grand a day. They were
yeah.
25 fucking grand a day at one time.
How much was like a gram at that point, do you think?
25.
Yeah.
Jesus.
25. The Russians on fucking Sunset by Rouse were charging 30 for a gram.
The Rock and Roll Rouse, right?
Rock and Roll Rouse. Yeah. They were charging 30 for a gram of Obama and 90 for a fucking eighth. They were straight up gangsters with that weed.
Yeah.
That place on Formosa, what was that place that we used to go to, the pharmacy?
Yeah, but no, it was the West Hollywood Collective.
No, or something we like used that. To go to a pharmacy for a while. Where we
bought
oh, the
yeah, the pharmacy with the
where
F.
When you bought the tickets for us to go see Clemens pitch, and it was 1,000 yeah. degrees in August
yeah.
against the Dodgers, and Ralphie bought a bag of edibles mm-hmm. at the other place. Because the pharmacy had like ice cream, and they were going out on a limb, Italian ice, and
yeah.
But the other place next to the breakfast joint that we used to go to there,
the
by Whiskey A Go Go,
yeah,
that
down
place there.
There
with the black chick, the hot yeah. skinny
oh
black
my
girl,
God. Yeah, she was fine.
They used to have cakes in there, Lee. Ooh. That would fuck you up, like chocolate cake.
They were like 400
milligrams. Yeah, 400 milligrams. And I remember we took him to a fucking Dodger game.
And this was before you had the tolerance for it.
This was way before tolerance. This is when you ate shit and went home and cried yourself to sleep and shit.
Yeah.
Your ears
were
humming.
We went to a Dodgers game?
Yeah, we went to a ball
game.
And
it was 1,000 degrees. You, me, and John Wesley.
Yeah.
And we sat right under the sun, dog, with those edibles, getting a fucking suntan. And yeah. brewing. That sun was cooking those fucking
How many
edibles.
Waters did you buy from the guy? The water guy when it came
oh
by 77?
God.
All
oh
of
God.
Them, dude.
We were fucking drinking.
I handed him a
We left after
bill.
Three or four innings. It was intolerable.
Yeah. It was too hot.
The ticket was so good that they were bad because yeah. it was right in the sun.
Right in the sun.
Yeah, those are tough in L.A. Especially, there's something weird about heat on edibles for me.
Yeah, no, like, no, they make you sweat a little.
Yeah,
extra.
It makes it yeah, like, yeah. I don't know, I don't feel good when if I'm too hot, I can't do it edible.
I get hot, like it's one of the weird, Joey always makes fun of me that I pass out in the studio when it was really hot, when it was the summer, I would take my shirt off. I have no idea why. I don't take my shirt off at the beach, and I was taking my shirt off here with the door open because they turned the AC off, and I was just hot.
At least Syatt don't take his shirt off in the shower.
I don't.
He's like Josh Wolf's hat.
It's fucking crazy. Let me tell you something, man. That shit makes me sweat like a motherfucker.
Oh, my God.
Like, I refuse to exercise. Like, if I eat an edible... And I get somewhere and there's stairs.
Yeah.
Like, I'm fucking pissed. Even if it's two little stars, which will not get me high, they will fuck me up when I'm walking up those stairs.
Yeah.
And when I run out of breath, it makes my mind think I'm passing out.
Yeah.
Like, I went to radio one time in Boston, the elevator broke.
Ugh.
And that motherfucker made us walk up to the third floor. By the second floor, I'm like, dog, you better bring the radio station down.
I'll do a phoner from down
yeah,
here.
Yeah, I'll do a phoner from down here.
Yeah.
I thought you were going to say like the eighth
yourself.
Floor or the tenth floor.
No,
the third
dog,
floor.
But these were long. It was an escalator.
And
there
it's
were three
Boston.
Escalators
the ceilings are really high.
That the fucking electricity went down. So they wanted us to walk
Jesus.
Up.
Jesus.
They were running the radio show on a generator. I can't do edibles and do anything. Like, once I do edibles,
I don't blame
and I walk unexpectedly, my fucking heart stop. My heart fucking beats too
much.
What
about going downstairs at the old office? I used to have a freak out whenever I was drunk. Windows.
Those are kind of steep stairs, man. Those freak me out.
Oh my god, yeah. And I'm fine. I get a little nervous sometimes if I'm out and it's like rainy or something. But if I'm sober, I'm fine. That was my biggest panic at that office, was that people were going to see me walking down the stairs and they'd know I'd be stoned, because it took me like 5 minutes once, because it would take like a couple tries. It was scary. You know, like my depth perception's off.
I hear you.
It's a different, but it's, I kind of like now going out when I'm stoned. It's funny, because I've always liked watching people and giggling at them, but weed just makes that 1,000 times better. Just watching crazy, like I almost want to go back to a city. I've never been in like a city really stoned, like Boston or New York, and like get to like sit and watch a whole city move by.
Boston's aggravating, and you have to be very careful they'll leave, because those Boston white people are a different type of white people than you've ever dealt with. Case in point, Lee, I had done a show there for New Year's in like 2000. There's ice everywhere, snow everywhere.
That's true, yeah.
It is probably 18 degrees at the most. And I saw these two guys walk up to a hot dog place and start beating the living shit out of each other because one of them put ketchup on their hot dog. Okay? And they beat the shit out of each other with blood. And then he goes, I told you not to put ketchup on it, and gets up, and they put their shirts back on and walk off together. They're the craziest white people you've ever seen, dude.
I grew up in the suburbs of Boston. I've always hear stories about this stuff. I never really get to see it. I think the winter would be a little bit tough, especially when it's like the same how hot freaks me out. I think super cold would freak me out too if I was stoned. Like when you can't breathe a little bit, when the cold takes your breath away.
Man, okay, I was just in Fargo, North Dakota.
Oof.
Last month, it was negative 22 degrees. The wind chill, negative 40. It was so cold. I went outside to smoke a joint. Literally, I thought I was going to pass out. It hit me so hard because it was so cold. The weed did. And then...
Well, when you walk into the warmth... It's like being in high school. You smoke outside, then you walk into the high school.
Yeah.
And the weed levels off a little bit because you're in warm weather. Yeah, it's right. Deep. It's.
Man, it was so.
Was that the coldest you've ever been in?
Yeah, that was the coldest I've ever been in, dude. I mean, I can't describe it to people. I mean, Coco, in my bus on the inside, the windows were all closed, the bus heater's on. I have a space heater on top of that. I am under 6 inches of blankets, all right? And there's a water on top of my blankets that's about 18 inches away from the window, and it completely froze. And it was inside in a heated place that far away from the window. That is how fucking cold it was. I've never experienced anything. I tell you what, those people up there,
they're tough, man.
They're the fucking toughest motherfuckers ever. People think they're tough guys. All right, you ain't tough till you do that.
When I was in my fourth year of comedy, I moved back to Boulder and I started getting work as a feature in different cities, you know, not in clubs, yeah, and one nighters. These guys were booking stuff. And the first weekend after New Year's, I went to Riverton, Wyoming, and it had to be that type of shit, and it snowed. So I remember being at the hotel, waking up like 11. There was no breakfast in hotels in those days. There's no free breakfast.
Stop.
You woke up, and you had to look at that front desk dude and go, where do we go? And I asked the dude, I go, where do I go to eat lunch? He goes, I wouldn't take a chance. You driving? I said, no, I'm walking. He goes, you ain't going to make it.
Yeah, you wouldn't make it.
He goes, you ain't going to make it. And I said, yes, I will. And I went out that dog, and I walked and walked. It was fucking brutal.
Brutal, dude.
It was fucking brutal.
Especially with the wind. The wind is at least for me, is what got me.
Oh, my God.
It was cold and under your skin. The last time I was in Minneapolis was January, 2-3 years ago. And it was one of those days. And I went outside to smoke.
It cut you.
And as soon as I went outside, I could feel the jeans getting cold, like my skin touching against the jeans. And already they were cold. You can only stay outside and smoke maybe a half a joint. I'd turn it off and hide it right there at the Mall of America in the bricks.
Genius.
That's exactly what I would do. And I'd go back an hour later and hit it, take it off the brick. I do that everywhere. I find the dumpster and put it on the ledge. And you go over a fucking trailer. There was in Jersey, there was a trailer they just built behind the hotel in Edgewater. There was still a construction trailer. It had a flap. I put the joint on there. I'd smoke half and put it on there, go to my room.
Come it's back better than you.
Was late and what happened
when you would smoke cigarettes? I know you don't just smoke cigarettes anymore, but I've always wondered that. When you have to smoke a cigarette and it's that cold?
You go outside.
Jesus.
And trust me, with the cigarette, you fucking... It could be 10 below fucking zero and you go out there.
Yeah. My tour manager, Ben, he was out there in it. It would take him 10 minutes to put on all the extra clothes to go outside and smoke a cigarette.
Now, did you grow up in cold weather?
Arkansas had four seasons. You know, we had definitely had four seasons. It would get cold. I mean, you know, we had holes in our house, so it was it felt colder than what it really was.
It's funny because I grew up in cold weather.
You grew up really in cold weather, man.
But the weather has gotten colder with climate change, is that what they call it? Like global warming and everything? Even this rain we're getting in California, they're getting history making.
Yeah.
Like yesterday it rained 4 fucking inches in Long Beach.
Is it true that we're not in a drought anymore? Is that true?
I have no fucking idea.
I know you don't know, but...
No.
Listen, they were never in a drought. They were growing weed. They got water to grow weed. They ain't no fucking drought. You know what I'm saying? Right or wrong? Right? That's why I still took long showers. They got they got water to grow weed. They got water the fucking lungs.
I take showers.
For a year, I would only take long showers on the road. I'd get in the hotel room, and it was like fucking paradise. I was like Mad Max when they found fucking gasoline. I just laid in the fucking tub for an hour, let my fungi nails soften. But now I said, fuck that shit. When I'm home now, I go in the shower, bitch. I steam everything. I steam the muffler. I don't give a fuck.
Coco, you take 2 showers a day.
Three times.
When I lived with you, it was at least two, maybe three. Water was free. Fuck it. Let's do this.
I love fucking showers. I love going in there and breaking the monotony. Jerry Seinfeld used to have a joke that he put on his Rodney Dangerfield special about the shower. No, nobody could bother you in the shower. Nobody could ever bother you in the shower. Think about that. He's too busy. He's in the shower. You're in the shower. You're in the shower. And you see that hair and you wonder how it got up there. You get how it would just creep his way up the wall. That's early Seinfeld, dog. He was on fire that night.
Man, that guy, he is so good. And yet so boring to me. I find Jerry's jokes so boring, but he's so good. Like, from purely just joke technique and everything. I mean, he's brilliant. But what he has to talk about does not fucking interest me at all. About your fucking socks. I don't give a shit. I don't give a shit about putting your keys in your shoes at the beach. I don't give a shit about any of that. Well, you know? But he's so good at doing it.
Somebody fucking cares.
Dude, of course. He's the fucking greatest.
They're paying him a ton of fucking
money. I know. What do I know?
They just brought his
I'm drinking Mexican
Netflix.
Coke next to a Jew and a spick.
Netflix just brought Comedians in Cars drinking coffee to Netflix.
But he's also doing 2 specials for him.
Wow.
He's doing 2 specials, so it's like $50 million deal. It's crazy.
And I love Seinfeld, the show. I've seen a couple of his stand-up specials. What's interesting is I've only seen it before I started this and before the storytelling comedy came up. So I'd be interested to look back on it, even because I like it. I think it's funny. But now that I don't even know what the word is, but the genre of comedy has changed a little bit. I don't know if it stands up.
I paid to see him. I paid. I took a girl on a date, maybe 1992 in Denver. I took this girl on a date, and I did stand up. I was like an open mic, and she knew, and I took her down there. And he was great. He was fucking great. He did like a Q&A at the end.
Oh, wow, really?
I was ready to ask him a stupid fucking question. I'm happy I didn't.
So it was before the show then, if it was 92?
It was around the show. The show was, I don't know.
It was the show starting? It had a tough first season.
I think the show was starting. I don't know.
He had a really hard, tough season. A lot of people don't understand how.
Well, you know, they always said that if it was today, the show would have never made it because they would have fucking cut him by the fourth episode or something like that. But I still watch the show on the road sometimes. Man, I still watch it and I still giggle.
That shit makes me laugh, man.
Makes me giggle. I still remember the night that show ended, how it was like a fucking big deal. Like,
yeah.
Improvs didn't even do stand up that night.
No, it they was got a Thursday. Big
screen. It was a Thursday. They got a big screen and just people came in and watched it for free.
John Panette, I saw that episode the other day. John Panette was great and they were making fat jokes at him and that's why they went to jail. Hilarious. I love that episode. It was so funny. John Panette was great.
Is it on something that you could watch it from the beginning? Is it like on Hulu?
I think
Hulu?
It's on Hulu. Yeah,
it's on Hulu?
Yeah.
I like to start watching that from the beginning. You know, this fucking CISO, they have a couple specials on there, but they have something very interesting, Ralphie.
What is it,
that
buddy?
When you fucking not doing anything, pretty interesting to watch, they have the very beginning of Saturday Night Live.
Oh, wow.
The pilot with Carlin, the whole fucking thing. Just watch for 4 or 5 episodes.
Wow.
It's pretty fucking interesting.
Man,
and you won't. It's not gonna be. I don't want you to. I'm not telling you it's hilarious.
No.
Oh my God! You wait till you. See, I didn't say that.
No.
I said just watch it. Next time you're in the hotel room and can't sleep, just go to CISO TV and press Enjoy to give you a month for free and fucking watch it.
Dude, I used your month for free and I watched your special. I watched Dougie's special, Dougie Stanhope, and I watched Lori Kilmartin. And
how good is Lori Kilmartin's?
Phenomenal.
I heard it's phenomenal.
Phenomenal. You know what? It's like, I tell you what, HBO and Showtime, they better get their fucking shit together. But because between Netflix and Hulu, those motherfuckers are going to be out of the comedy business. What I like, as far as like those specials I saw on CISO, okay, as opposed to the last 3 specials I've seen on comedy, I mean on HBO. HBO is hot garbage in comparison to Dougie and you and Lori Kilmartin. That's no bullshit.
I'm gonna tell you something, man. Times are changing. You know, times are changing and they're moving fast. And I told you that a week after the special came out, I got a call from an agent that I almost signed with. And he congratulated me. He goes, I learned something very interesting this week that somebody else had put on an HBO special. Nobody's talking about it. And you put on a CISO special. Everybody's talking about it. And everybody's watching it from 9 to 5. He goes, next time one of my clients gets an offer from HBO, I think I'll only do it if they only put it on Saturday night and then stream it afterward.
Yeah.
Online. If not, it's really not worth it.
No.
And you learn. You live and learn, man. You know, everything's changing. Your audience now is from 9 to 5. It's the people who go into offices. 10 years ago, they couldn't find this. Now, we're all over the place. They listen to Bill Burr. They listen to Jim Jeffries. They listen to
Joe Rogan. Oh, my goodness. Joe Rogan,
100 million downloads last month.
They listen to you, Coco.
They listen to here. I mean, yeah. No. It's this game is changing.
Mark Maron. Oh, my God, yeah.
It's fucking crazy.
Ever since we had Ray Kinnella on, I'm always looking. He runs a Roku channel or a YouTube channel.
No more.
No, okay. He used to.
He sold it out or something.
Wow.
I went to this restaurant the other day, and the owner's daughter was watching a YouTube video of, like, that guy PewDiePie who plays video games and talks about it while he's playing the games. She was watching that on the 60-inch TV at the restaurant, like, because it was her father's place, and I she was like, had to be under 10, and I'm like, that's the future. They have cable there, they have all, but she's watching a YouTube video, and it's interesting. Like, maybe HBO.
Was it a YouTube stream or a YouTube video?
No, it was a video, because you could go back and forth. It was crazy. Like, it's like HBO is sort of like the Jerry Seinfeld, like that. Like, they're still on that platform, and then YouTube, it's everything's changing. Like, I would never have wanted to watch a YouTube video instead of TV. I had a computer when I was growing up, but there was no, I remember I had a Rambo on video disc. There were no real videos or anything. Now, that's all
people watch. Was it First Blood or Rambo?
I think it was First Blood.
That's a deadly movie.
Is that on YouTube now? Like, all those movies are on YouTube? Is that what you're saying?
Probably to sell.
There's like YouTube Red or something like that.
Right, yeah.
So I think they're all on there.
Right, you have to rent them, you have to buy them.
Yeah, It's.
But that's the thing. People don't want. All people want now is, like, even I saw some, like, Sam Tripoli tweeted something today. Like, someone was, like, 6,000 people were on Instagram Live watching this workout trainer working out. That's what people want now. They want quick. Like, I almost, whenever I'm at home with Paula, I don't. We really don't watch movies that often. Like, I think this weekend we watched one movie, but it's all TV. Like, it's, we all want quick, and it's the movies have been so bad. I think that's why they're going to YouTube and stuff. I don't know. I mean, haven't you guys found?
Yeah, man. I mean, I got that Fire Stick, that Amazon Fire Stick, and we had it hacked, and so we get all the movies and stuff like that. Bro, so many of the fucking movies are not worth a goddamn dime. I mean, are total shit.
Even for free, there's no point.
Yeah, there's no, I mean, we'll turn off a free movie just because this is killing my head. You know, this is a headache.
On my TV last week, I love Chael Sonnen. I think he's amazing at trash talk. I pulled up like a 20-minute best of Chael Sonnen trash talk video and had a better time watching that some kid put together by himself on his laptop than a TV show or a movie. It's pretty interesting. And it's, I don't know. I mean, I think both of you guys have had a huge career growth from online video.
Man, Netflix for me flipped the script, man. I mean, you know, you do four with Comedy Central and it's good. You do one with Netflix and it's all more than the first four with Comedy Central. I mean, it's, but you know what? I was lucky because I took less money for the specials and did them on better cameras. You know, it cost me more money, but because of that, Netflix bought all my ones that were on Comedy Central, and they were the first to go out on those when they used to do just DVDs. Do you remember that?
Absolutely, yeah.
And they when they first went to 1080, mine were already there, and that's one of the last like four I've shot were in 4K, and so they're still going to be good for years and years and years. And I took less money, but it's better for me in the career. But man, Netflix, dude, I'm going to Australia in April because of Netflix. I've never told a joke in Australia, and I'm going there. It's crazy.
It just opens up so many doors because your special now is worldwide.
Yeah.
It's fucking just, it's too, I didn't know what the fuck you were talking about, Lee, before. I'm high, you confused the fuck out of me that you went to PewDiePie. And she was watching the restaurant. You and Paula watch. You and Paula watch fucking nothing.
It was also you a 10-year-old
fucking
kid.
Terrible shit. Anyway, you stay home. It's like Jim Jones fucking. It's where Jim Jones gave out the Kool-Aid. You're just waiting to give out Kool-Aid to shoot yourself out. The other day they were watching Animal House. I was so fucking happy.
Yeah, that's right.
I was so fucking
Animal
happy.
Animal House is a
he's
phenomenal movie.
28 years old. He sits in at night and watches Cheers. You want to shoot? You want to shoot him? You want to fucking shoot him? This is what I got to deal with.
What are you doing, Lee?
He watches Cheers.
I like Cheers. I'm making my way through.
He thinks he's in fucking Boston.
Making your way through the world today? Is it taking everything you got?
It really is. Sometimes, be nice to know.
I haven't.
What a shoe would help a lot. Come on.
I don't even know. I don't even know what to watch anymore. Like I judge a movie, brother, right from the fucking trailer.
Man.
And I could tell you from the trailers now if this is the movie.
Yeah.
Do you follow me? Like, you could see it and go, that's the movie. That's as good as that movie is. Garen, fuck, don't even take a genius no more. Don't even take a genius. I grew up a movie buff. I still watch trailers. You could see it. You know, all these assholes that did a movie and it was great, but they were on top of their game at the time. And when they went to them with sequels, they said, no, let's move on. Like Jim Carrey with that fucking Death Trap and Santa Claus 2, which Momo finally went to see after 3 weeks. After the fucking double day canceled, he still went three times. That was the sign right there not to go see Santa 2 because they made them years later when they needed the money.
Right.
And they just did it. And then they just got...
It's just garbage.
They don't even care. They just keep putting out shitty shit. Yeah. It breaks even in the box office. They sell it to international, and they make a little profit, or it's a fucking write-off.
I heard for when that fucking CBS is redoing The Honeymooners.
Yeah, that's a true story.
Oh, my Listen, God. Listen, man,
there's not an original fucking idea left. Not an original idea left. This new youth is fucking
worthless. They're garbage, dude.
This is hot. Garbage. And the networks have caved because they don't know what to do. They've panicked. So they said, what shows work? The Honeymooners. They didn't know that it was The Honeymooners with Jackie Gleason.
Yeah.
That was said at The Entertainer. You know, they didn't know that it was fucking Uncle Buck with the fat fuck, not fucking the black dude.
Yeah.
You understand what I'm saying? And I got nothing against nobody. I'm just telling you the truth.
But John Candy.
Yes, John Candy was Uncle Buck. That's it. Leave it at that.
Yeah.
Leave it at that.
Yeah.
Leave it at fucking that.
Fuck yes.
You but see, they're remaking Training Day as a TV show, but they just switched the races.
Oh,
yeah,
that's all they did. They just made the blind. Yeah,
I mean,
that looks god awful.
If you can't say my nigger, okay, then kill yourself. God awful. Okay, you can't say my nigger on fucking.
I saw that yesterday doing football, and I was
oh my god,
they're using that fucking mutt from the Titanic to be wild and shit.
Seriously though, dude, you got to be able to say my nigger.
Have you watched? Have you watched Lethal Weapon?
You know what? I like it.
Oh,
I like that.
I think it's brutal.
You think it's brutal? I like it. I like Damon Wayans.
It's tough to play Riggs.
It is. It's real tough to play Riggs.
It took. I was such. Lee, here you go. When I got arrested for kidnapping in 1987, Bruce Lee died in 1983. In 1987, if you came to me and said, Joey, you got to watch this Kung Fu movie. I tell you to go fuck yourself. I hated Kung Fu movies more than ranch dressing.
Just because of your Bruce allegiance
Lee.
To Bruce
There's
Lee?
There's no reason to watch any of those stupid fucking movies without Bruce Lee. Right?
He was here first.
I like Chuck Norris. Chuck Norris, Men Wear Black, Good Guys Wear Black.
Dude.
Dog Code of Silence.
What was that Bruce Lee where they just start like warming up?
Return of the Dragon, all that shit. But Chuck Norris.
Chuck Norris
till about 85, the Octagon, whatever.
What was that movie?
Return of the Dragon. Him and Bruce Lee fought and the fucking Coliseum. But until that time, I wouldn't see Dick. Like if you came to me with one of your stupid fucking movie ideas back then, I'd tell you to go fuck yourself. But there was this one dude in Boulder at the car dealership from Detroit, Michigan. That was my dog. His name was Jim Wheeler. I lost contact with him 10 years ago. He's from fucking, where's that comedy club outside of Detroit that's been there? Mark Ridley's Comedy Castle. What's the name of that town? That's where he was. Oak. Something Oak. He was from there.
Oak Brook or Royal Oak?
Royal Oak. He was from Royal Oak, Michigan. This motherfucker met Bruce Lee and got a book with his autograph.
What?
The Tower of Jeet Kune Do. He was cool as shit, Jim Wheeler. He was a kung fu dude. He fucking came to see me when I was in county. The whole thing, he got me a job when I came out of county. But he kept bugging me before I got arrested. The night, he kept bugging me for weeks to watch Lethal Weapon and this movie with this fucking dude, Steven Seagal. The one where he's fucking great.
Oh, he only did one good movie, and that was when he's on the boat.
No.
Under Siege with Tommy Lee, and they're doing that knife shit.
The first one is tremendous.
Nah,
Under the first one is fucking.
Which one is?
Dog. The only reason why he made that one on the boat was because the first.
It must have been good.
It was tremendous.
But what was it? What was the name of it, baby?
Above the Law.
Oh, that was a good one. I thought. I got it twisted up.
Okay, he made Above the Law, which then he went on Letterman and made an asshole of himself.
Yeah, right.
They asked him if it was the real CIA. He wasn't the CIA. But he was married to Kel LeBrock. And if you're married That's to deadly. Kel LeBrock, you're always welcome at my motherfucking house.
Yeah, right.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, let me smell your hand.
Kel LeBrock and Weird Science. Good googly moogly.
Holy moly.
When you're a kid, your head explodes.
And what do you guys want
to
do?
Yeah, that like, whole fucking thing. But then he released the one when he goes to Brooklyn. Who shot Bobby Lupo? That one wasn't bad with Sticks and all those. That's what the dude from Law and Order. Who shot Bobby Lupo? And he fights it. It's all about the mafia.
Dude, I saw you the other day on fucking Law and Order.
William Forsythe is the gangster in that. And you know the girl that Tony Soprano hooks up with that he buys the real estate from? That she's on that show now?
Hard to Kill? Yeah.
No.
No.
What's the show that she's on now? Viviana Margulies or something is her name. She was Tony Soprano, and then she started dating Christopher.
Yeah.
And then Christopher was doing heroin with her.
Right.
It's her first movie. She plays a hooker. She's the gangster's hooker. And Steven Seagal. So that's that one. And then the third one was the horrible one, when he gets shot and he goes into a coma.
Oh, yeah, that was horrible.
And he wakes with Kelly LeBrock, and he wakes up, and he's fucking no paralysis, no fucking... Yeah. What's that thing you go for training after you wake up?
Rehab.
No, nothing.
No.
He woke up from a coma, and he was throwing sidekicks for Jesus 2 days later. Fuck you. And then after that, it all went downhill and shit. Yeah, who gets out of a coma and starts beating people and choking them out and shit? His cardio.
I was in a coma. I couldn't work a spoon in my mouth, okay? What the fuck are you talking about?
He came out of a coma. He's beating up fucking muscle guys and running 4 miles.
That's a true story. Almost drowned in applesauce.
That is fucked up. But no. Above the law is the real fucking deal, my man.
It's deadly. That's a great movie. But, dude, I saw you the other day talking about Alexis. All right, taking out the trash on that fucking Law and Order, dude.
Which one?
The one you were on. You were taking out the trash. Oh, you were telling the cops about the fucking like SVUs or something. Yeah. Dude, it was great.
I did two
scenes. You're getting a check.
I did two scenes, but they fucking cut them. They cut the one.
Oh, they cut the first one?
Yeah, they cut. It was the fucking coldest day of the year, my friend.
Ooh.
You understand me? And the fucking, I had a $20 bill, Lee, and I walked into a store and I said, hey, let me get a pack of cigarettes and something else. Listen, it was $16 fucking dollars. And I almost shot myself. I go, why is it $16 for a soda and a pack of cigarettes? He goes, cigarettes are 10. That's when I shot that, which had to be 2006.
Yeah.
I can't imagine what cigarettes are in New York. So next time you go to New York, pack heavy. In fact, there's somebody who could, Gene Pompa quit, because he said he went to New York and he went downstairs. It was $10 a pack. He goes, I'm done. Wow. Done, yeah. It was 10. I got a Schnapple and a fucking pack of smokes, and it was fucking $17, 16, and a lottery ticket, $17 or something. I was like, what the fuck?
Jesus.
And the wind was coming. See, this was before I was trying to tell you about global warming and stuff.
Oh, yeah.
But it changed in New York because there were all those tall buildings got built. Mm. All those buildings along the Jersey coastline facing New York City, they all got built. So that slows that wind down. When I was a kid, I still remember I could still go through maybe 4 nights. One night I was coming from Judas Priest at the Palladium. I went over there by myself. And I came home. My mom had just died. She'd been in the grave 2 weeks. I said, I'm going to see fucking Judas Priest. And I went over there, and I got off that Boulevard East bus, and I was walking up to Kennedy Boulevard. And a wind got me, and I was dressed to kill. You know, like, not dressed to kill, but, like, you know, parka, hooded sweatshirt, boots. That wind got a hold of me, man. My fucking spine almost, bro. There was one time in Riverton, Wyoming.
Yeah.
I remember. The night Freddie Prinze died.
Oh, wow.
I was a kid, and I remember finding out when I was out. We were fucking kids, and we got, you know, in those days, you drank a bottle of Boone's Farm, you know. And I ended up drinking a fucking, like, 2 bottles of Boone's Farm, and we split, like, a $10 bag of reefer. And I walked through the cemetery. This was a shortcut in North Bergen. A lot of people know about it. You're going through 64th Street, right behind the projects.
Okay.
You come out on 46th Street. And sometimes you bump into Santeria people, or sometimes you bump into real devil worshippers and shit.
how much time are you saving on this walk with devil worshippers?
20 minutes, but you're a kid. Jesus Christ. You're just 20, 25 minutes. Because at night you got to walk all the way on Kennedy Boulevard and then walk down 43rd. Now you just crawl through somebody's backyard. Like,
yeah, right.
We had a spot where we had made like a little hole. You just come out of somebody's backyard right there. They live bordering the cemetery. But I went in that cemetery. It was fucking freezing.
Yeah?
It was freezing, and so I had to take a shit. So you know me. I'm a Catholic. I'm respectful. There's all these fucking old graves. I looked for the oldest grave.
The Gavin shower wasn't anywhere near.
Like 1891. Like 1891, dog. I went over there and pulled my pants halfway up, and I started looking around real creepy.
Yeah.
And I took my little dump, and when I pulled my pants on, I had peed in my pants, and the cold weather had frozen them already. Oh, I had shingles God. On the outside. There were fucking shingles on the outside of like that when it gets iced over.
Yeah.
Oh, that's how fucking cold it was. Like, I still remember that night.
Damn.
And one night I went to the fucking Island of Insanity party at Hudson County Park. If you go to Hudson County Park in January, it gets so cold that the river freezes, and this little island where ducks live, all my friends would go across that fucking pond with kegs, and I took a fucking Quaalude. Oh, this is a great story.
You rape yourself?
No,
I took you didn't Quaalude, do no Cosby.
Me, this kid Lebrano. And this fucking dude, Joe Focaraccio, nobody knew we took these Gorilla Biscuits, and we knew they were strong. So we inhaled these Gorilla Biscuits. We went to the Island of Insanity. We got so fucked up with the Island of Insanity, we had to go, dog. We had to fucking go get something to eat. So we went to the Wing Fong. It was on Bergenland Avenue when we were kids. We were professionals.
Wing Fong?
The Wing Fong Chinese restaurant. We were on foot, so we couldn't walk the chance. No, we couldn't walk the chance. It was fucking freezing. We walked out of Hudson County Park. We made a left, and there was the Wing Fong. But the problem with the Wing Fong was we would always dine and dash in that motherfucker. So as soon as we walked in, these motherfuckers started lining up. They called their cousins, their uncles. So we had money to pay that night.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Like, we just sat there.
You had to keep them off guard?
We had to keep them off guard. Now, there's this kid, Joe Folk. He's still on Facebook today, and he's got a hook nose.
Joe Hook.
Joe LaFolk. They used to call him Joe LaFolk. So me and Lubes are sitting on the same side, and Joe LaFolk is over here. And we're talking. We order egg ribs and pork fried rice and shrimp and lobster sauce and pop, pop, pop. And we're reading. Everybody's eating.
Pork fried rice with no peas or carrots.
And all of a sudden, Joe Focaraccio is fucking feeding his face. Right? He's feeding his face. And all of a sudden, I could see. It was like he ate four stars, right? He got fucked up, Lee. And all of a sudden, his face, he just fell into the Chinese food. And he's snoring, right? He's fucking snoring at the table, right? And I'm with Lebrano, and Lebrano's going, Falk, you're embarrassing me. Falk, get up.
Why would you go to Chinese food after this?
Because we were fucked up and freezing. And in those days, you couldn't go home smelling like reefer and like duck shit. So to tame the high from whatever pill we took, we went to the Wing Fong. And we fucking ate, and we stayed there for like, we ordered extra noodles. We took our time because it was 10 below fucking zero out there.
Man, yeah, fuck that. That's cold, Jack.
And I walked home that night, and I fell asleep in the hallway of Gollum's fucking hallway. There was a building next to Dragon Grocery. It's still there, and it's still called Dragon Grocery. On the way down to my house on Givenaught Terrace, it's still on the corner there, one of the longest hills in North Bergen. It goes this way, and there's a bodega there. And next to it, there's an apartment building. It's like three floors, and you have each floor. Yeah. I knew the girl on the third floor. And, I must have been freezing. I blacked out by the time I got down there. I got off Kennedy Boulevard. I blacked out. I still remember I had a baby blue hooded sweatshirt with, like, a duck vest.
Yeah?
Like a duck jacket. The whole fucking jacket. So right. I was pretty warm. I had gloves on and shit. But it gets better. I wake up in this hallway. With this fucking, like, I slept in a fucking hallway.
Was it even a hallway, or was it the alleyway?
Where people's mailboxes are.
Oh, okay, so it isn't.
It's in a hallway.
It's inside. Yeah,
I mean, it was still cold in there, but it wasn't 22 below. I fucking woke up, bro. I went to the grocery store. I bought an orange juice. I drank that motherfucker, and I tiddled my way down the hill. But I know
you love orange juice.
Dog, I had this fucking jacket, right?
You motherfucker love orange juice.
I don't drink orange juice no more. Can you believe that?
Oh, my God. I used to
have this feather jacket. In those days. And one day my man Veneri had a Mustang, like the two-door white one. That was the only car the family had that was white. It was his sister's. And once he got old enough to drive, they gave him the Mustang. So he's driving on Kelly Boulevard. Somebody says, can you give us a ride home? He goes, come on, get in. We all get in there, but my duck jacket gets caught in the hook. And he left the window open. So within 3 fucking minutes, the wind was hitting the duck and there was feathers all over the fucking car. He was pissed at me for like 6 months. You know how it is to vacuum feathers out of your car?
Well, Mary.
Was Tony better, that cocksucker? Took him a year to get all those feathers out of there. Fuck you.
So funny. Coco, you're hilarious.
I want to be around to pick up the pieces when somebody breaks your heart.
Well, he's going through changes tonight. See, you don't go through these changes when you're at home with mama holding hands, watching fucking Cheers.
I don't eat 11 red stars and 1.5.
Do you not pick up a bag of fucking stars every Tuesday?
Yeah, but that's a whole bag.
So what do you do with it? You stay with it. Here's what I'm talking about. You go into training. Oh, yeah, baby.
What's up?
Who'll leave you to learn?
Yep.
That
the picture behind you.
Yeah, China.
Wait and see. I mean, I want to be around.
Unfucking believable.
Man, you know, I was doing a show in Louisville at the old improv when it was there. And I ran into Tony Bennett, and he said his assistant, which was like a 30-year-old hot chick. And he was performing the next day, and I go, Mr. Bennett, if y'all are just putting it out there, Mr. Bennett, I'm a stand-up comic, huge fan of your music, Anthony, and I'd love for you to come over and see the show. Didn't think a thing of it. That was a waste of my breath, right? He came to my show and stayed 2.5 hours for that show. I didn't even know he was in there, and. At the end, I was doing those finger-banging shirts, and he goes, hey, Ralphie, can I get a shirt? You know, the fingers. And that was the coolest I've ever felt, was when Tony Bennett was asking for a finger-banged shirt. How strong is that?
Poor Tony Bennett.
He's bad,
bro,
man.
He's badass. 80-something? He's badass. 80-fucking-something. That Dude. Song came out the day I was born.
Oh, no, it didn't.
Yes, it did. Look it up.
I believe you.
That's fucking crazy.
He's so good, dude. He's still killing it. I saw him last year with Lady Gaga.
So he's got to be 80, right?
He's older than 80, I think. Look it up, Lee. You got the computer.
The computer. You sound like my daughter.
He is.
The computer, daddy.
90.
What?
He's 90.
He was born in 26.
Yeah. That's fucking heavy duty, my friend.
That's as good as it gets, Jack.
That means if he stops, he dies.
Yeah.
That means if he stops working, he dies. He knows that he'll get stiff and shit. He doesn't want to do that. So he keeps fucking moving. He probably paces himself. Probably does a show every other night like Black Sabbath was doing, you know.
Yeah.
3 shows a night when you're 60. You know, when we had the doctor on here one time, I asked him, when you prescribe testosterone, who are your biggest clients? Movie stars? He goes, for a while. Or football players? He goes, but it's musicians. He goes, all my musicians have fucking testosterone. And they go out there fucking 3 nights a week. And
yeah.
Look at U2's coming back.
Man, they're playing Joshua Tree. They're playing Bonnaroo this year.
I don't even want to know what they're charging for tickets. I just thought
$300.
About, yeah, it's got to be three because Cat Stevens was charging three at the Beacon fucking Theater last year. Yes, he did.
Wow.
Yes, he fucking did last September. $300 a ticket. Wow. That's the welcome to the new...
Name?
What?
Didn't he change his name to some like Muhammad shit?
I don't know. But my friend's a Cat Stevens fan. He paid the $300. And I know for a fact I heard her tonight and I was thinking about her tickets. When she came to L.A.,
who?
300 was light. 300, Barbara Streisand.
Oh, my God,
300
yeah.
was light. I was telling me and Lee were howling.
That's a different audience,
the
though.
The first row, that's the top Jews.
And oh, my God.
Those they fly over from Israel. Yeah. They take them out of a cave. They
you got
come over to L.A.
In there, right,
just
Lee?
To be seen in there.
They got
just to be seen amongst those Jews, Like that circle, you pay $10,000 for the cookies. Ticket.
Come on. Come on, tell me, Lee.
Arugula cookies. No. Come on. She was, yeah, that's going to be the new, yeah, so you know this for a fact, you two's charging three?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And that's the shit seats. I mean, that's what they're getting shit. At the door. Okay, and oh, everyone, shit. I mean, they're doing Joshua Tree. They're doing just Joshua Tree.
Which an is album tremendous.
It's just a fucking amazing album.
1987.
It's an amazing album.
Bullet to Blue Sky.
The cheapest ticket I can find for their Agoura Hills one is standing room only, and it's $50.
Who?
$52. You two.
Wow.
So to stand up, you have to. I don't know. Like
the place in Nashville is $300. Cause I was trying to buy it.
Where are they playing? Bridgestone?
Yeah. But they might not now because they just got Bonnaroo. They're going to be playing at Bonnaroo and there's going to be 90,000 people there.
They'll still sell out two nights later in Tennessee.
Dude, oh my God.
Still sell out in Tennessee two still nights out. Later.
Yeah.
That don't mean dick with them.
No, but Bonnaroo gets real shitty about that. They don't want nobody performing. They didn't want me performing anywhere in Tennessee for like 4 months before and 3 months after.
What's up, Doug?
I think most people spend their entire working life like hoping for retirement. Do you guys think about retiring at all? Is that even a goal? I mean, that could be like doing nothing or doing a couple shows a week. I don't know what that would even mean for you.
That's a U2 tribute band.
No, it's Hollywood U2, and that's just opening for them.
That's a tribute band.
No,
oh, Jesus Christ.
No, it says U2 tribute.
It says Hollywood U2. Look, I swear to God.
All right.
You say I got to deal with?
That's his opening for them.
Do you say I got to deal with?
I swear to God.
Do you say I got to deal
with? I'm not that much
Agoura in Hills. Where are they playing at Agoura Hills?
The Canyon Club.
No. YouTube's not the Canyon
Club. Yes, they are.
No, not, they're not. You
it's
big dummy.
Hollywood U2.
You big U2 dummy. This is what I got to deal with. You see what I'm saying? As much as you're slipping, that's it. Take a stripe from him. I knew what I'm saying. Where are they going to play in Agoura Hills? There's only the Canyon Club. They're not going to do the fucking Canyon Club.
They'll play the Staples.
Yeah. You said I
so why do they have it on their YouTube website? It's just Hollywood I don't know.
You say I got to deal with. I try.
I took
you
know a strike.
Fine. Okay. Here, is this a good one? You two in the Lumineers at the Rose Bowl?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay.
At right. The Rose Bowl. The Rose Bowl. Not the fucking Canyon Club.
I thought they're opening up at the tour. I don't know what they're doing.
Yeah, jeez.
Where's that song before? Remember Black Sabbath when Ozzy was stuttering? Where is it? We should just put sound bites on and shit. Fuck that. Guy. He eats those fucking stars. I tell him, be careful with those stars.
I know.
You can't be in training every
it's
night.
$55. Okay. It's $55 for standing room only at the Canyon Club for a U2 tribute band. Okay.
My God.
So, okay.
Who would pay that?
I don't know.
I got to get their fucking emails.
No shit.
Them fucking morons. Oh my God. I went to see the two. Oh my God. They were so
amazing.
Oh my God. I might
Maybe
march.
You're just tricking people like me who didn't know.
Yeah. That. You'd be up there.
YouTube Bono!
And it's some fucking chubby dude.
Yes. It's
how much
Bobo.
How much they want for tickets?
At the Rose Bowl, they want $250.
I told you.
Oh, shit.
The Rose Bowl is fucking huge, man. Was it hold 60,000? 70,000?
Oh, my God. I'll hold on a second.
Yeah, look at the price of these tickets. This is California.
And that was for general admission below. Up top, they went, I'm sorry, 430. I guess maybe that's a better angle. I don't know. It's saying.
Yeah, they're retiring.
Oh, my well, God.
Do you want to confirm this? Just think some, make sure
I'm no, no, you're on the right. Rose Bowl. Yeah. That's the right. I mean, I was like 55. I don't think so.
Where has America gone?
Oh, dude.
This is why I'm watching Cheers. This is like.
Okay.
This is,
leave me alone. All right, huh? Leave me alone.
Well, no, I'm saying it's the same thing. It's the same time period, in a way. Wow.
What time period?
Not exactly, but like.
Are they
like,
listening to YouTube on Cheers?
No.
Well, maybe 80s, 90s. I don't know. I don't know when U2 is around.
Are you playing with me? Are you
I don't know when U2 is around.
Are you really trying to drive me crazy?
When was U2 started?
YouTube, the first time I remember about YouTube was maybe 82.
No, you, okay.
82 or 83.
So, yeah, they were listening to YouTube.
Somewhere out there.
So they were. What?
Why they're so good, dude.
They're really
they're
so fucking good, man.
Really? You like YouTube?
Oh, my God, yeah.
And they fucking blow it up in concert. You'll sit there and fucking drool.
It seems like Bono would annoy you.
He got annoying. He got on my nerves on one of the tours. He walked on stage with a cane and shit. Let it go, okay?
Stop.
Jimmy Page never had a cane. Yeah, like all that shit.
Yeah, fuck off.
But you know what, man? He shows up and he delivers the goods. And the guitar player is a savage. The bass player is a savage. The drummer's a fucking savage. They're all fucking savages. So I ain't mad at nobody.
I know.
I love music. I like what they do. I like the early shit. I like some of the shit they play on the radio sometimes. I mean, I wouldn't go buy it if that's what you're asking me, but I like it. I really like the Joshua Tree, but I ain't paying $250 at the Rose Bowl. I
gotta park. For shit seats.
And it's $50 to fucking park, and it's $9 a beer. You know what? I'll buy the fucking CD and put it on my iPod. And the next time I take a 5-hour flight, I'll drop Purity Stars.
Yeah.
And I'll do it for fucking free. Okay?
Man, those dudes with those stars need to hook me up. Those are great.
We'll hook you up with a fucking email. You can take the stars with you. You know what I'm
saying? Fucking love it.
You want another one?
Fuck yeah.
Fuck yeah. Lee, here's one for you too.
Oh, sure, why not?
There's three of them. We might as well.
Fuck yeah.
Fuck yeah.
Right. Come on, Lee. Oh, shit.
Like this, Lee. Bow!
Can I have another water, please?
There's no more water.
Have some of that.
Thank you.
There's no more fucking water.
Okay. Why can't you just swallow it?
I don't taste that.
It tastes pretty good.
Mm-hmm.
And watch. He's going to about puke. Watch this. He gets fucking...
No, just try to eat 12 of them. I like them. I love these drinks. Oh, my God. These are... I personally, what do you think, Ralphie? I think gummies are number one edible for me.
Yeah. That or the old breast strips. Did you ever try those?
I came out after the breast strips. I didn't
try them. Oh, my God. Those are great.
And now, are they extinct for sure? Yeah, nobody's got them.
I think just one place still got them. That place over in Santa Monica. By La Cienega.
Really? Right there in Santa Monica?
Mm-hmm. If not, they should. I'd go in and buy them out, man. I'd go in there and drop $2,000 on those.
I mean, that's the whole point with an edible is just to get it over with, to do it quickly, to not have. I mean, I like smoking. I don't mind smoking, but it just doesn't last long enough for me. So edibles, I think that's why I don't like the big cakes and the cereal
nobody
bars.
Does. Nobody
Some
does.
People do.
They're obsolete. Those things.
Yeah.
They're obsolete. Those big things.
Oh, my God.
I don't think anybody's making cakes anymore.
No, no.
There's a company that has them. Remember the guy showed up here one day?
Right, yeah.
And he had, like, really delicious stuff, but 60 milligrams. I'm wasting 3,000 fucking calories.
Yeah,
bro.
No way.
It's not worth the aggravation. It's a fucking huge piece of chocolate cake they got. It's a, but then I don't see baking goods anywhere.
No.
And I generally go to four places. I got that place, Buds and Roses. I got Perennial. I got the Russians, number one. And I got the people over by Victory there. And I don't see those. I don't think there's no more banana bread. I don't think there's no more banana bread.
Even that banana bread was deadly, though, Jack.
It was delicious. I don't think there's any more banana bread. People won't go for that.
That banana bread was
they
so
want,
good.
You know, the stars are 7 calories.
Yeah.
7 fucking calories. You don't even know this in your system.
Mm-mm.
At night, you wake up to pee at 2, and it's real yellow. But that's it. It's glowing in the dark. You wake up at wow, and in the morning, you go, oh, shit, that star has some kick to it.
Yeah.
That fucking mule, look at that toilet. It's shining and shit. It looks like that shit in the fucking, what's the old man movie? The shit they stole from the moon and put in the pool. What's that movie with Cocoon?
Oh, Cocoon,
like Cocoon.
Yeah, exactly.
It glows like Cocoon and shit.
Yeah, right?
You wake up at 2, you pee with those stars of death. You're like, ooh, that kidney's working overtime, Jack.
I know.
We're putting the strain on those motherfuckers. We might as well eat steroids and kill that fucking liver.
Speaking of Ralphie, Joey has tried to, he does torture me.
He's the
recently
best.
With his boogers. And I think you must have been around at that time. Have you ever seen him eat a booger?
Who, Coco eat a booger?
Yeah.
No, no, no. My favorite Joey booger story is we were at the Comedy Store in like 2000, okay? And me and Joe Diaz were the only ones smoking weed, okay, up there. There were a bunch of lamos. It just wasn't in. Me and Coco were it. And we kept on getting the ear beating from this black guy who said he was a producer from Fox. He was just doing this to come into the shows. He probably wasn't even a PA, a production assistant. You know, this guy was there, and he was so fucking annoying and telling us about what TV show we should do and stuff like this. And Coco, I guess he had a head cold, and the boogers he was pulling out, Lee, They were like hard at the beginning and then like really thick and wet at the end.
I've seen those.
Okay, tremendous. You know what I'm talking about? They're amazing. It's like half Triscuit, half snail. Okay, all right. And he'd take those and he'd go to this guy and rub him in. Okay, that guy must have had 20,000 snots on the back of his jacket by the end of the night. Coco, I saw this one too. Lee, he got one going on one finger, all right, and then went with the other nostril with the thumb, all right, and so he had two. And that one looked like a fucking seagull shit on that guy's shoulder. Oh, it was so thick, and it was amazing. And this guy was such a fucking asshole. It was the most tremendous.
I used to put snots on my high school teacher, Mr. Zink. And I used to hang out with a daughter. He used to wear the same black jacket every day. And once or twice a week, I'd go up to him and tap him on the shoulder and say, "What up, Mr. Zink?" And his back had fucking thousands of little dried snots. He would never wash the jacket. It was just my little snots on. Who else did I put a snot on? I put a snot on a few people.
But that guy, the producer, was the fucking best, man. That was the best.
Man, there's so many charlatans that came to the store.
Oh,
over
so
the years.
Many. So much shit.
So many people called me and sent me emails with just so much bullshit. I don't think people understand. It's not the auditions and the other shit that
it's
wears you
bullshit.
Out.
It's the bullshit.
It's the fucking bullshit.
My God.
Oh, my God.
Why do you think
God.
I live in Nashville?
I think that's the fucking key to this, just to avoid those people. There is so much bullshit you have to cut through when you first move here. And at first you look at these people and you're like, really? You're doing this? And then you find out they're fucking extras. They're
so full of shit.
Oh, my God.
Oh, my God. If somebody's doing a day extra work, all of a sudden they starred in this movie. Or you may have seen him in that movie. It's like, no one saw him in that movie. You know? It's just annoying as shit. But speaking of movies, dude, you gotta tell... Does the church know about the Eminem story? Does the church know about the Eminem?
Yeah, yeah.
When you throw it at someone in the movie?
Yeah, yeah. And it bounced off his fucking head.
Okay, all right.
The guy had the Eminem, and he was showing it to the manager.
But he had a big ass bald head, and he had a red spot where you hit him with that fucking Eminem.
You're triggering me right now, Ralphie. This is bald hate.
Oh my God, Lee! Oh my God. It was a fucking peanut Eminem. So that fucking red spot.
That's
was that
hurt.
Big. It was that
you
big.
You whipping them at this point?
Oh my God!
No, I don't think we're whipping them.
No, you whipped the couple.
No.
You whipped the couple, motherfucker. It wasn't just a lob. It was a bam.
No. What bam. I was doing was. I was throwing them up in the air.
Let me tell you, there was a couple of overhanded, man. There was a couple of overhanded. You went through a whole big fucking box of fucking M&M's because I bought them and I'm fat and I wanted them.
Yeah, me you too. That's what I was thinking. Like, why are you throwing these M&M's?
But not the bag, the box, those big boxes, when they used to do it right. Oh, my God. And that guy getting hit.
Yeah, and it wouldn't be better to lob it because it's going to pick up steam. You probably only throw it to the top of the movie.
You could hear the M&M in his head.
He had it one in his hand.
And then the movie started. And throughout the movie, he was looking for the M&M.
He looked back.
He had the flashlight out. He had the club manager in there. He had everybody in there. I'm sitting there like, I don't know what the fuck's going on, right? He knows it's us or the black dude in the corner. He's looking at the black dude.
Oh,
Jesus. It was fucking terrible. He knows it's me and Ralphie. There's nine people in the movie theater.
Yeah.
It's either me and Ralphie or this black dude sitting there by himself yeah. with his hand on his cheek like Napoleon. And he's looking it up like it's either curtain number one or curtain number two. He takes the peanut. He goes out there. The movie ends. I thought he went home because his head hurt. I thought he went home.
I told you, you binged him. Did I tell you? I told you. I knew his head hurt.
We need to hear Ralphie.
He had the rest spot that big.
I thought he went home to put ice on his head, right? The movie finishes. I forget all about this fucking dude.
We're walking out.
And he's got the fucking peanut in like a baggie with fingers.
Like evidence. It's evidence.
Oh, my God. And we're dying.
Lining it up to the bruise on his head.
I need this fingerprinted. Oh, God, Cooker. So funny.
There has to be, like, a Facebook group for all the people that you tortured throughout the years.
Oh, my God.
Look, we don't know who he is. He's a masked man.
Bro, since I was a kid.
Set your asshole on fire.
I'm going to be honest with you guys. Since I was about six, I've been the king of the lob.
What?
Like, I'm the type of guy that'll get a rock and go 5 feet away from the corner of a roof.
The king of the
lob. Like the 11th floor.
Yeah.
And I won't even look down. I just go, whoops. And take my chances. And then take the elevator down and see if there's somebody down on the floor or if it went through a windshield.
Yeah, right.
When I was a kid, I was fucking crazy, man.
What are you lobbing?
Rocks, pennies, whatever I could get up to that roof and get away with.
You were going to kill somebody?
I would throw it off the roof. I didn't give a fuck. I was crazy. I did not know. You know, when you're five and six and you run around, you don't know and you don't give a fuck. And then my family took me to Puerto Rico. Whoops. And we went to fucking San Juan. And we got in a hotel. And the hotel was, we had like the fifth floor. And my mom and the ladies went out. It was just ladies and me and the ladies' boys. It was me. The kid's name was Johnny Crespo. And there was another kid there. I forget. My moms were all friends. I had to be like seven. And when they left, I went out in the balcony and started throwing ice cubes off the fucking balcony. And I could see the island. You know, I would throw like 10 of them and get the timing right. You know what I'm saying? Like a couple would be walking, all of a sudden it land over here. And they look. And they go, fuck you. And they walk, you know, sideways and keep walking. So I would sit there for like 10 minutes, you know. And that one night, right there, I threw it. And I saw the thing hit this dude, and he goes down, his wife goes down. And I run into my room, I put the bucket in, you know, the whole fucking deal. And within like 20 minutes, they knocked on the door. And the guy had to be taken in a stretcher, the whole fucking deal. They measured where the ice cube could have came from. They wanted to check the balcony. They checked the balcony. Some of the ice cubes fell out, and there was water now. So they asked us to fucking leave, and they were going to press charges, and it was I told you, I was a devil when I was a kid, dog. I was into all that shit. That was my world. Throwing shit at people and tormenting people. That was my fucking world.
I don't know if you remember, but did you feel like it was exciting to do something? Did you know it was wrong? Like, I remember as a kid doing stupid stuff.
I used to buy, my mom had a bar, and in the jukebox there were 45s. Okay, and I lived on the third floor on 205 West 88th Street. Mm-hmm. And there used to be like a parking garage where people would park their cars and walk out. I'd be on the third floor. But I was in the deep corner. So I would take the 45s and whiz them out my window. And they would whiz out and go down. And from time to time, you hit somebody and go, what the fuck? Like I would hit them with a 45 to the head. And then I turned into, you know, once my dad, and I thought about this when I'm writing this book, I thought about that time period. It was a scary time period for my mom. One time I almost set the building on fire. Oh, I fucking went behind 88th Street, and I started lighting little papers I love doing that shit. You light one paper, you light two papers, and you push the envelope until the side of the building is on fire. And I got to tell you something, guys. To this day, I remember taking my dick out and pissing. Like, this is going to put out that fire.
That was your first thought, to
and
pee
I,
on it?
And I peed on it, and I ran away, and I went to my room, and like 10 minutes later, I saw the fire department back there and shit, and I was giggling to myself. I was one of those lunatics. I was one of those crazy fucks.
Someone's yeah. house is burned down, and you're giggling.
Man, oh, Coco, have you ever told him about what you used to do to Bobby Slayton?
No, leave Bobby
alone. Dude.
Please leave him alone, please. Dude. No, leave him alone.
Oh, my God.
No, please. I don't want no drama over there.
There's no drama. No, I talked about it with him this summer. We were dying laughing.
No, you didn't.
I did.
No, you didn't.
I did. Are you not going to tell these people?
No.
Oh, my God.
I feel bad. I can't.
Hey, listen, Bobby. All right. I need you to go outside. All right. There's a rock right by your mailbox. Underneath that rock is a package. All right. I tell you what. Because I got to go pick it up. You go out there and leave your money there. All right. And I'll be right back. Okay. All right.
The best was when I talked to him and he'd tell me where he was at on Friday night. He told me where he was at on Thursday. So he's in
Tempe.
Let's say he's in Tempe. All right. I know if he's in Tempe, I know the hotel he's staying at. Right. Okay. So he can't figure this out. I would call the hotel. I'd have this lined up from Thursday. Once he told me on Tuesday where he was going, I would start my torture chamber on Thursday. He would ask me if I knew anybody in that town. And I said, I'm not sure, but let me call the blind Mexican.
My torture chamber.
And I'd make up a name of somebody who was down there, and he had a particular type of cocaine. I wouldn't know at this time. It could be. I would tell him it was El Chapo's cousin. And he's got the coke from 1984, you know. But I would start setting him up on Wednesday. I would ask him, are you taking some down there? And he goes, I'm taking a little bit, but I'm going to probably run out by Saturday. Perfect. I'd cave him. I'm going to talk him into doing it on Friday night. Right? I'm going to talk him into doing it all on Thursday. So Friday night, he's got to struggle. And by Saturday, I got him on a hook. I got him walking miles to the corner, make a left down this alley. You know what I'm saying?
All for no payoff for you. Just
none. I'm at home howling my ass off.
That's it, though.
When 10 minutes later. All right, so I'm on the... Listen, you know, it's 2 in the morning. It's 1:30 in the morning. I get home. I'm stoned.
But it's 3 in Houston.
It's 3 in Houston. It's probably 5 in New York, right?
Oh, my right? God.
So let's say I know Ralphie's in New York. I'll call Ralphie at 3 in the morning. He knows. Yeah. And if he's up, he'll pick it up. Oh, God, what are you doing? And I'll break his balls about spellbinders. They redid the floor or something. And we're back, right? When I get off the phone with him, I leave him with like a question. Like I go, Ralphie, yeah, let me know if I can do that weekend, whatever. And when I get off the phone with him, I'm like, ah, who can I torture? And I call. This is why I had Slayton in the box. By this time, he's looking all over Tempe. He can't find no blow. And this is when I set him up. You know, I tell him, I get him perfectly. I call the hotel, ask them what the name of the bar is on the corner. I call the club.
No Yelp.
Oh, yeah, no Yelp. I call the club, ask them who the waiter is. Oh, I'm a professional.
With no cell phones. With no Google.
No, and I would call him up.
It was a beeper.
What's your creepiest waiter name?
And I call him up Thursday. I call him up Thursday at 5. Oh, I know he's in his hotel room. He just had a vodka. He just did one little blast. He's listening to the Stones. He thinks he's Keith Richards. About 5:45 is when I put the first call into him. What's going on? Nothing. I'm sitting here. Hey, did you find out? Did you get me any? I said, listen, I'm waiting to hear right now on the amount. But I did speak to Chapo's cousin. And he's on the mule right now. I'm going to give it to a friend of his in Tucson who's going to bring it to you on Friday night. You know that junk you brought down with you? Do it. Get that away with me. Because you don't even want this around you when this shit comes up to you. The shit they're bringing is what the three wise men showed up with. And I get them salivating at the mouth. And then I call them again at 10. I tell them that I got in touch with them. Got in touch with them. And what does he want? And he'd tell me, I don't know, two or three grand. You know what? I like you. They're going to bring you seven. One big fucking rock. Wait for me tomorrow, okay? And then he'd call me all day, and I wouldn't answer the call.
Kunkko be at my house going, nope.
No.
No.
He'd be calling me all day, and I'd be setting him up. And then I'd call him, and I'd go, Bobby, where you at? Listen, good news. He's on his way. Click, hang up on him. Oh, you know what I'm saying? Where you at? Listen, Bobby, hold on. You there? Bobby, you there? And he'd be yelling, I'm here. I'm here. Pick up. And I'd hang up. And the next day's when the torture really began. Okay, so I call him and go to the corner to the Stagecoach bar, sit at the table and ask for fucking Manny the Waiter. Oh, I'd get him going. And he wouldn't know whether to ask him or Manny the Waiter was in the town. And then once that foiled, he'd call me back. But see, it's like jujitsu. I did the first attack, but I'm already anticipating the second. By the time he calls me, he's going to say, I went into that place, I sat there for 3 fucking hours, and the fucking waiter didn't say nothing to me. His name was Manny. I go, what'd the guy look like? I don't know. What the fuck? They all look the same. You know, he's Mexican. He 5'8", brown hair. I go, this guy's fucking white.
You stupid. Yeah.
But he's gone now. He's gone now. Now the mule's coming.
You would call him
stupid.
Then
I would call him that night and tell him to meet him at the fountain down by the University of fucking Arizona State down there. Walk to the fountain. But I can't. It's raining. Go to the fountain. He's going to meet you at the fountain.
Would you ever go like real deep? Like, but don't take your car; they could see you. Take a bus.
Oh, I would. No. I never took them to those murky ones.
Okay, listen. I was there when Kunkko said that he had the yellow Peruvian gold. Okay, and Bobby, you could hear Bobby. Oh my God, I haven't had that in forever. It's a Peruvian gold. All right, and Bobby, I'll put it outside. I'll put it in your mailbox in an envelope for you. All right, I'll be right there. All right, have that goddamn money. Don't fuck around this time, Bobby. Don't fuck him. Don't fuck him. And then he'd hang up, and we'd sit there for 3 hours laughing our ass.
I would have three coke dealers on the hook at one time, and I would torture two of them. Would just get tortured. Like, if they said to me, I'm going to leave it in my mailbox, oh. You just doomed yourself, because that comes with 1,000 stories.
And by the way, this is exactly how he does it whenever we're doing like a lot of edibles or something like that. He'll call me starting 2 nights before, tell Paula to stay at her mother's. Do you have your interest?
Tell Paula to stay.
I don't want her to find you on the floor. You know what I'm saying?
2 days. Oh, my God. That's so funny.
I'm saving that acid to crack him.
I'm not,
when he sees this acid, I'm waiting for the fucking perfect night.
You almost give me a panic attack on Wednesday, by the way. That's why I took a lift here, by the way. I never do that anymore. I took a lift here because he had tortured me for about 36 hours, and I was convinced that it was the strongest, most potent in the world, and I was gonna freak out.
Did you take a lift home that night?
I had to. My car wasn't here.
So funny.
All right, so talk to me about this fucking Vegas thing.
Man, it's great. We're at Harrah's.
How many weekends a month?
At first, it's going to be 4. I'm starting next week, and I go for 4 weeks.
And so 4 weeks straight here in Vegas?
Yeah, yeah. It's just Thursday, Friday, Saturday. At one show at 10 o'clock. It's the best show in Vegas. Thursday, Friday, Saturday, 10 o'clock. That means you can go out, have dinner, okay, at a reasonable time. You can get some drinks in you, come see me. You're done at 11:30. And that's perfect. That's when Vegas starts rocking. You know, that's it's so much fun.
So they go right from you to fucking playing blackjack.
Fuck yeah. I'll be out there with them. These guys at Harrah's, I mean, Harrah's is a Caesar's property. They give me chips to go out and gamble with. I'm going to be on the $5 chip. That's fucking cool. You know, these guys are really, really spending a lot of dough. They're giving away trips. We ought to do one on here, bro. You know, you love your fucking fans. The church people, I love them. Why don't we send a couple of them out there to Vegas?
Whatever you want, brother. You
dude, let me get it together. Church guys, church members, listen up. We're going to fucking get a thing together where you listen to Coco, all right, and my brother Lee, and I will fly you to Vegas, wherever you are, Canada too, wherever the fuck you are. I'll fly you to Vegas on me. We'll put you up. You come to the show, all right? Maybe we can get some of those stars or something. I don't know. We'll work something out, okay? All right? So I'm talking to you guys like D in Colorado, Noble, Darren Noble. I love him. And my man Ookie Spooky. I love that guy.
Spooky, Tammy Winkler. Oh, that's my girl and shit.
She's bad. Well, she's everywhere.
Let's give some shout-outs while you mentioned this shit. Paulo Ofoglo. Louis Hector, Jesse Lindquist, Dom De Niro, my brother, MMA Insider,
the fucking
Spanish German, Leon Vega, there she is, Tammy Winkler, a.k.a. Luki Spooky, Julian Thomas, and Horning. I love you motherfuckers. Thank you for always doing your thing, you know what I'm saying?
Our friend Bobby Sharon had the cold today or the flu, so.
Everybody's got the fucking cold.
Something, man.
Get well. Yeah, I told him to get well. He put something up there. No, this is good. You're in Vegas for 4 weeks straight.
Yeah, man.
Everything slows down for a while. And then where do you go for 2 weeks after that?
I'm going, those 2 weeks, I've got a weekend in Canada at two casinos, Calgary and Winnipeg. And then I think I got a week off. And then I'm back at Harrah's for a couple weeks. And then
Couple more weeks in a row?
Yeah, and then I go to Australia. I'm in Australia for 2 weeks.
And you come back to Harrah's?
Yep, go right back to Harrah's.
This is how many weeks altogether?
28.
Nice.
28 weeks. And, you know, the deal they're throwing at me is phenomenal. You know, I mean, I can't ask for anything better. A suite that's bigger than any apartment that we've ever had.
And you're gonna stay there all weekend?
No. Well, I'll stay there Thursday, Friday, Saturday, and I get the fuck out. Dude, I'm taking a page out of Dr. Coco's book. Sunday is for my house, my family. I either gotta go see my dog or I gotta come see my kids or something, you know. But I can't be in Vegas more than 3 days in a row. It's crazyville.
It's tougher, especially when you like buffets. Like I love buffets. If I
hate live there, buffets.
You hate buffets?
Yes. I'm going to do you a favor, Lee. Any food you're eating at a buffet, somebody did not want that food. They picked something else besides that. That's disgusting. Think about that. They're all breathing on it. They got AIDS.
They got those little plastic.
Stop. Covers. Stop. They don't stop AIDS. Ask Coco. He knows. That don't stop AIDS.
AIDS jumps right at you.
I had no idea. I've loved buffets. I miss a Chinese buffets from back east. They don't have it out here.
Good. You're lucky. You're too fat to do that. You can't do that.
I love that's why I can't. But I love it. If I lived in Vegas, I'd go every day.
No, you would. That's disgusting. I wouldn't let you.
I am a love disgusting food.
What do you mean? What do you eat?
Everything bad.
Everything bad.
Yeah, I love it, and that's.
Seriously?
Yeah, I love burgers and not at buffets, but like what are like a buffets? Buffets are like Asian food, like dumplings, Chinese food. I hate breakfast buffets. I think breakfast buffets are a waste of time.
I like brunch.
Why? You can make eggs are $8, and they always charge like $30 for breakfast
buffets. Dude, let me tell you what something, Lee. Because you're young, you don't know. Blowjobs and egg benedicts are exactly the same. You can only get them in hotels. Okay, all right, that's it. All right, you can't get them nowhere else. All right, I'm telling you, that's what you want, man. That Eggs Benedict is the fucking what's up.
I'm excited that you're taking a breather and just going
to Yeah.
Chill. And then you'll come back here on Wednesdays or on Sundays.
Yeah, I'll be doing a lot of Los Angeles press, you know, so I'll be coming in on those off days and stuff. And, you know, maybe I can come in here and hang out with you guys. I love it. I love it. You know, even if you got other guests, I just want to hang out with you.
You still drive by Garner when you come to town?
Every time. Every time. I'm going to do it tonight.
Does it remind you?
It does. It keeps me humble. You know, as I look, I remember where I fell in front of my house where you thought, Ralphie, get up. They're going to think I mugged you. Ralphie, get the fuck up. You got to get up. They're going to take me to jail, Ralphie.
About a month ago, fucking something happened. There was a lot of traffic on Laurel Canyon, so I went the long way. It was like 1:30 in the morning. And I shot up that street. I parked under that tree. And it was pretty, for like 10 minutes, man. It was like I was waiting for you.
Yeah.
It was like, for fucking 5 minutes, I just thought about Ricky, and I thought about Gavin, and I thought about Celine, and the fucking sisters from Houston, and I thought about Doug Stanhope, and the fucking crazy buddy who had the apartment originally, his friend.
Yeah, Matt Becker.
And just how many years we were down walking
around. What about that neighborhood, man? I mean, Dougie was there, Mitch Hedberg was there, you were there. I mean, everybody was in that neighborhood,
next to Apollo, Josh Wolf.
Yeah.
It was a great little neighborhood, man. And you got to see it now. It's like, you know, there used to be that hotel on the corner.
Right.
On Vista.
And I remember, that hooker hotel, right?
It was like a dead hooker hotel. And I remember making a turn one day and seeing the pool. And it was fucking algae with cigarettes in it. And there was a condom floating. I'll never forget looking up. And there was a mom with three kids and a husband. And they were tourists. You know, like when they sent them the picture of the hotel, the pool was cleaned up. It was like, and they were fucking... I remember going, what a waste to come to fucking California there. But there used to be a print shop there on the corner named Charlie Chan Printing.
Yeah,
I gave that motherfucker millions of dollars in the beginning, from printing the resumes to
headshots
to cutting them.
Charlie Chan.
But Charlie Chan.
There used to be this kid. I don't know how the fuck I met him. It was right around the time of The Longest Yard, when weed was starting to percolate, and he just popped out of somewhere. And he had this weed that killed Lincoln. Fucking Louis Pasteur. This week was fucking everybody up. He was a Dallas Cowboy thing. He had a Dallas Cowboy tattoo on his head. And he would always give me weed, like sell me weed, but it was fucking high powered. And he was a guy that got so fucked up in L.A. one night that he went out with his friends, snorted a bunch of blow, took a pill, didn't even know, got on a plane, and woke up in fucking Florida. And they called his parents, and they put him in rehab for 6 months.
In Florida? Did they even let him leave Florida?
Like, something weird, man. Like, it was just... The story was amazing. I forget what the fuck his name was. I can't believe he just came into my mind right fucking now. Wow. What a weird situation. We met some fucking characters down there, man. That was... That was a long fucking time. Listen, next week I'll be here 20 fucking years.
Wow.
20 fucking years. On February 19th, on my 54th birthday, I'll be a regular at the store. 20 fucking years.
Wow. Wow.
I never did nothing. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, like, right.
Just to be at the... And dog, the whole time
I was... I'm at 18?
Yeah.
Oh, my God.
Yeah, you were here right after me. You came right after me.
Oh, my God. 18? God damn, Coco. It don't seem like it's been that long. Mercy.
You had the manager that had the cancer.
One foot in the grave, another on a banana peel, Ralphie.
Banana peel, Ralphie. You got to sign with Jimmy Masala, Jack.
Yeah. Okay, Coco, let's go.
Fuck.
You cracked me with that one. I was a nice kid. My manager, Ben, when I first got here, she signed me in San Antonio during the Latino Laugh Festival. They fucked up and let me go first, and I got a standing O. All right? So she signed me on the spot. Come out here, and within a week and a half, 2 weeks, I found out she's got terminal cancer. All right? All right? Okay?
That sounds like something that happened to me.
Okay, all right? She had terminal cancer. My whole reason being out here, I've already said, fuck everybody in Houston, fuck you, I'm going to L.A., suck my dick, and now my manager's fucking dying. All right?
But she had you, she had Monique Marquez or somebody.
Yeah, she had Medina.
Okay, so
yeah,
one
Joey
day,
Medina.
She was a little kind of fucking dirty. Right? One day I had a call from her, and she goes, listen to me. I just got off the phone with these casting people at CBS. I had done dick at that time. I had done the pilot for CBS and maybe basketball, maybe not. She called me. At that time, I was getting tormented by people. I was at Ken Phillips.
Yeah.
Okay, and I was getting tormented by weird things, Phillips. Like weird.
Oh, my God.
Weird offers in those days. Like, there was a guy that went to the Comedy Store every night to torment a bunch of comedians, and I was one of them. And he had a company that booked extras. And he would come to the Comedy Store and go, what are you doing tomorrow? I'm going to put you in the lead. Like, he would come around while they were shooting Titanic. I moved here when they were shooting Titanic. Everybody had a job for you in the Titanic. They had four different casting people sending 50 people a day down to Rosarito, Mexico to work on the Titanic. You would go to a place, they'd take a picture of you, and within an hour, you were in a fucking van taking you to Rosarito. They had the ship there parked. They put you on there, and you didn't know you were going to be union. You might not be non-union.
You were in Titanic?
No. That was the big ticket sell.
Okay.
When I got here. So if you wanted to get to be in a movie, you'd go to Rosarito, Mexico, and they cast you for the day. Remember at the end, they had all those violin players and all those.
Yeah.
There was thousands of people on that fucking boat, or at least it looked like it. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. That was the hot job. Every fucking backstage, everybody could get you an extra job on the Titanic. But this specific company would be at the store every night tormenting me. Listen, you could be in the movie tomorrow. What if the director likes you and he upgrades you and he gives you a line? You know, come on down tomorrow morning, take a Polaroid. What do I need a Polaroid? And then I would question.
Why?
What do I need a Polaroid for? If you already told me I got the part, yeah, tomorrow I get it for you. They just need a Polaroid to see what size shirt you wore. What the fuck? It's going to cost you $40. So in those days, you were getting $35 a day or something fucking crazy. Like, you were getting like $75 a day or something, and you had to pay him $30 or something crazy. That's no fucking deal. You know, there were a lot of those guys.
But you get to spend all day on a bus to Mexico.
Yeah, but I wasn't going to Mexico. Some people fell for that fucking trick. What, why? You want to go to Mexico?
No.
I'll get you an extra Titanic, too. Cocksucker. So I get a call from her. I'm salivating in the mouth for a role to fucking, because they didn't like me as a stand-up comic. And there was a hot show at the time. I forget what the fuck the show was. And she called me one day, and she was telling me her father owned the Latin Quarter.
Yeah.
He knew Cuban people and the whole thing. And she goes, I really like you. I like to work with you. I got a, she goes, usually when a manager signs, you don't have a job for you. I got a job. You're going to make $10,000 on or some shit. She goes, they want to meet with you this afternoon. Sign with me. Come to my office. Sign with me. I'll send you right to the audition. And I was like, you know what? Send me on the audition, and then we'll talk. What the fuck? There's no trustee? And she was like, no, you got to come down and sign the paperwork. And I thought that was something kinky. And then a week later, Ralphie came up to me.
Yeah.
And he's like, she's dying. What do you think? And I'm like, you know what? Say la vie, bitch. Go sign with the Laugh Factory. She's dead and buried. This guy's
got one foot in the grave, another on a banana peel. This, what are you doing, Ralphie? She put any money in your pocket?
You know, fuck at that time, the Laugh Factory was the hottest club in L.A. Hands down. The hot club, not the improv was hot on Mondays and trendy on Thursdays.
Right.
When I mean hot, I mean that if you had a set at the Laugh Factory three nights in a row, something was going to happen. You either got an agent.
Yeah.
You got an audition. You got a commercial. That's how the first three roles were just industry.
All the time.
All the time. I can't tell you how many auditions I got just from doing Monday nights.
Yeah.
Gilbert Escobar's show. How many auditions? How many
calls? That was a great show.
On Monday nights when that genre was very hot, that was the hottest show in L.A. When
you had
Pablo, Carlos.
Deadly.
And Willie going in there every Monday, and then Paul
George
Rodriguez.
Lopez would go
George
in there.
George Lopez would go in there.
Paul Rodriguez.
It was really a fucking deadly Monday night. It was the hottest Monday night. Then they had Freaky Monday, and that got really hot. That was the genre at the improv.
Yeah.
And that was a great night because they put white dudes up till about 8:35. Then about 8:35, they put like a mixed guy up.
Mm-hmm.
Like somebody confused a white dude with an afro or somebody.
Yeah.
They would put David Tell up. He would kill that motherfucker, and then they would start Black Knight. He would. David Tell would go up there on those Monday nights and sizzle that fucking room.
Blow it up.
Blow that fucking room up.
Oh, I believe that. I was laughing at the white guy with the afro.
No, there's always some that spot. That 8:35 spot, they always reserved for somebody who was coming right. over a little on the rough side, because then the Black show started.
So why did they call it Freak? What did they call it? Freaky Night?
Freaky Monday.
Why?
That's because it was freaks. Hot chicks were there. People were ordering. That's where all that bottle service, it started all that shit at Freaky Monday.
Yeah.
Then fucking they incorporated Miami, everywhere else, but Freaky, I'm not saying as a city, I'm saying as an improv.
Right.
I'm saying as an improv. That was the first club to really have Monday nights. And then Monday night at the Laugh Factory was Latino night. Banging. Monday night at the
Comedy Store. Sold out.
Sold out. Monday night at the Comedy Store was an open mic. 52 people.
Yeah.
That's how different it was then.
Yeah.
The improv was packed.
The Comedy Store had nobody there. Comedy Store
was nobody on Monday night. 50 fucking people. Watch that microphone.
Okay.
Because if not, I'll slip out and shit.
Oh, really? Okay,
yeah,
I'm sorry, you'll be
cool. No, you're cool, brother. Yeah, in those days, there was a complete different. Tuesday nights, the main room at the Comedy Store was 500 people. The original room had 8 people. Tops.
Yeah.
Tops. I remember leaving, like, the bars to walk over there to do the spot because you needed the $15.
Yeah.
But there was guaranteed 8 people. Wednesday night, 64. Thursday night, 110. Or it was sold out on Thursday night. And then Friday and Saturday, it was sold out.
Right.
But it was always dead, the Comedy Store. Now it's completely different.
Now it's only the place to go.
It's the only place to go. The Improv and the Laugh Factory are dead.
Yeah.
So that's how it changes. It's not that the club is better now. The club was where Pryor was there.
Yeah.
But it gone through some years where it was rough at the Comedy Store.
Man.
So they
turned. Do you remember those nights we went up there trying to get our $15 fucking? And then, like, Eddie Griffin come in and do an hour and a half. And then Andrew would do an hour and a half. And then Paul Mooney would do an hour.
It was rough to be a comic up there. And you had, you know, you wanted to try material. Not only did you want to try material, let's be honest. You needed the $15.
We needed it.
You counted on that $15.
Yeah.
They paid you every 2 weeks. It was like, if you got the main room and 3 spots, you were okay. I mean, you weren't going to pay the rent with that.
No, but it was nice. But it kept
you in Chinese food and reefer and ying ying, that ching ching, you took me to chin chan.
Yeah.
It wasn't bad, man.
Mm-mm.
It's pretty interesting how we, you know.
Green Tea House.
The Green Tea House.
And Hoy's Walk.
You know, when before the podcast started, Ralphie and I were talking about how many people we had been out here with. And we were talking about what they were doing now. And it's pretty funny how we weren't saying nothing bad about them or anything. We were just talking about the situation that the only reason we're in this position here is because we stayed here.
Yeah.
This isn't no genius fucking move.
Just outlast everybody else.
That's it. That was it. We just, is it tough skin? Is it, what is it? We just stuck it out. We just believed in the dream and stayed, and things happened. Ralphie's been kicking ass for 12 fucking years, you know. But this is the podcast with Lee, the whole thing. This is 20 years in the making, you know what I'm saying?
We were doing this without the cameras and the internet. 20
years ago. At night, after the Comedy Store, till 4 in the morning, every night.
Oh, my God. Drinking Bloody Marys, Lee. And I was you. Getting fucked up on new drugs all the time. It was awesome.
I can only imagine. It's
4 in the morning. Lee, how long you know me? How many nights have you seen me in all those years at 4 in the morning?
The only time is when we woke up to get an early flight. That's it. We got never 2-4 in the morning.
We'd be up till 4, talking, laughing, listening to music, giggling, talking about fucking comedy and the politics of comedy. And
set my hair on fire.
And who he had worked with, and it seemed like such a long time ago, but it really wasn't, bro.
Isn't it crazy? It's weird, Coco. I mean, 20 years. God damn it, man. If when you got here and when you were skinny and you were showing your dick on Doug Stanhope's fucking door with the picture, okay? Did you fucking know that you would be here for 20 fucking years?
No.
Right?
At that time, when I was doing that and acting that way and having a great time and doing blow and hanging out with the stripper chick, I thought I would last 3-4 years up here.
Yeah.
How close did you get to move back? Like, or how, like, did you ever seriously think about it or no?
When I got into that last fucking tussle with the stripper, that fucked my head up for a month or two. I got on a plane and went right to Miami for like 5 weeks. And he paid me like $500 a week, and I bought clothes again, and I bought a black bag, and I bought t-shirts and underwear. I mean, I had to start from fucking scratch, guy.
Yeah.
I had to start from fucking scratch.
Where was all your stuff?
I got towed in the apartment.
Oh, that was
the apartment got towed. I couldn't get into the trunk.
The fucking headshots, the boxing gloves. The
trunk was in it.
The frisbee.
I got a lot of your clothes out, but all the good stuff was in the back.
No, nobody got nothing out. That motherfucker, they had that car under high patrol and shit.
Dude, they did.
They had that car. There was no way they would even let me go in the fucking trunk. I begged them at that police station. Guys, you can keep the car. I'm done. I understand. But at least let me take my shit out. Nope. They caught me while I was taking a shower. And all my shit was in the car. I was taking a fucking shower at a girl's house in Van Nuys. The tickets were from Hollywood. And I went out, and the car was fucking gone. And I knew. I knew they were going to clip it any day. And in those days, I'd always take my big bag of clothes in with me. But that particular day, I just went in to take the little set of clothes, and they got me in fucking Van Nuys. And that was the end of that car with all that shit. And then her and I got into a fucking a blowout. And I'll never forget, I threw a fucking ribeye at her on the street. She maced me, and I threw something at her.
The tooth.
And then she threw a roll of pennies at me. And I'll never forget that once she got in the car, and I said to myself, I just threw a pot roast at her or something. Like an uncooked that was marinating that we were driving with in the car. I said, you know what? This relationship has to fucking end.
Deadly weapon.
And I called Joe Chadwick in Miami, and I got him to give me an American Express number, and I got a plane ticket, and I went to Miami for like 5 weeks. And there was what's that fucking store that the clothes are real cheap?
TJ Maxx. Whoa.
Even cheaper.
Marshalls.
Old Navy. They had an Old Navy in Coconut Grove that had winter clothes for dollars, because who buys winter clothes?
Right.
I would go to Miami in January, and they would buy winter jackets for January for 2 weeks. They would be $3, $5, $6 out of a brand new banging fucking jacket for the winter on the road, you know, shit like that. I just bought clothes in there. It was, I came back, I stayed on Ralphie's floor.
On the couch, come on.
On the couch, the floor, John Westling.
We made Westling sleep on the floor, all right? The big guys got comfortable spots. But when, Lee, this is the truth. When we couldn't sleep, we're all talking, and it's a studio apartment, and you just get quiet, and then Joe Diaz would fart. And then, like, giggle. And then we'd start laughing and fucking, so one of us else would fart. We couldn't get no sleep. So Coco goes, put on that Joey Medina album. And we put on his comedy album. Oh, my God. It was a bootleg, a show of his. And we never made it past 5 minutes. We were all out.
No, you did not.
Yes, I swear to God.
That was
every
the
time,
joke in the morning.
It was like, dog, hey, how far did you get? How far did you get? How far did you get?
That shit got magic fucking powers.
Oh, my God. We never got past 6 minutes.
How many comics friends go to, like, insane asylums or... Like, I can't imagine being a friend of the, like, guys from Brutal. Like, listening to someone's, like, they're a year or more of their hard work, and you're like, I'm going to sleep in 6 minutes. This is better than a lullaby.
We're dicks, Lee, but it's the truth. That's what we did. I mean, was it better to lie, or is it better to tell the truth?
Oh, tell the truth.
All right, then.
I love it. I'm just saying.
I'll tell you what, man. Ralphie, I wish you all the luck in Vegas. I'm happy you're doing this.
Thank you, sir. I'll
slow you down a little bit. You've been on the road a long fucking time.
Long time, man.
A lot of miles, bro.
You got
nothing to prove. Theaters, small arenas, comedy clubs, crushing it. It's nice. You went to Vegas. You take a little breather. You get some sun. You breathe some desert air.
Yeah, man.
Yeah. You jump in a fucking steam bath. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. You know, I get to work out. I get a steady thing going. You know, I'll be in just two time zones a week, not six like we were in December. Okay. You know, I'll just be in my house or in Vegas, and it's like, That's the greatest. I mean, it don't get much better than that.
You can't wait to travel, and there's one day you go, you know what? This fucking 1 hour and a half before the flight shit's getting fucking old. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, man.
It gets fucking old, man.
Today we were thinking that.
All right, well, man, let me read these things and we'll get you the fuck out of here. I know you gotta
do
radio tomorrow.
I love you.
No, I love you too. I'm happy you came on. You know, I'm happy you came on tonight.
Man, you're fucking fans, dude.
They're great people.
They're so nice.
I don't even call them a fan no more. They're fucking family. They really are. They're gentlemen. The fucking clubs even say
they're so gentlemen. They come in stoned
to the gills, and they fucking
they order tons of food. They get cotton mouth, so they drink.
This is why I do this.
They're so good.
The other day I got on Lee. You would have died. I almost sent you to that. Looking to sponsorship, you know, this and media and this, and it's all bullshit because I don't want nobody fucking with these people.
Yeah.
Do you know what I'm saying? If anybody's going to fuck with them, it's going to be me. Let me fuck with my own people. I love these guys. They know I get up early and I play music. I have a good time, man. I would have done it anyway. You got to say, put something out there for them to get motivated. You put a Periscope tape out. I get fucked up on Periscope in the morning. You know, man, listen. It's an outlet now that we don't have to fucking wait to pitch something.
Yeah, right?
That's it. Those days are done. You feel like doing something, do it.
Do it.
Do it. Who gives a fuck what you say on that? Do it. That's it. If you start with three people, eventually you're going to get four. And eventually you're going to get eight, and then you're going to get 12. And now what, bitch?
Yeah.
Now what? I got 12 people watching me now for a week. You're going to get 13, but you keep doing it. And one day you'll get right up to 38. And you go, I don't even know how the fuck that happened. Do you tap? No. You keep fucking doing it.
Keep on going, man.
Nobody's special here, bro. Exactly. We just believed in that dream and kept doing it. We hung in there.
Fuck yeah, Coco.
We just kept showing up, bitch.
That's more than half the fucking battle in life. Show the fuck up. You know, I mean, when people wouldn't show up, who got their spots? Me and Coco, because we were there early. We didn't have no spots, but we were getting them and smoking weed out back on the steps like doctors.
When you're broke, you get to that spot early.
Fuck yeah, you do.
You get to that spot early. It's like that fucking first line in the Pope of Greenwich Village. Oh, how come nobody keeps me waiting when they're looking to borrow? That's my favorite fucking line in that movie.
Damn, that's a good movie.
Anyway, Me Undies has been on the podcast for a long fucking time now, and for one reason only. They're comfortable. I like how they feel, and I wear them when I go to the gym. They keep everything tight. Plus, they have a fabric, and they keep your nutsack nice and fucking clean. If I said it once, I've said it 1,000 times. When I had the surgery last time for my nose, I couldn't bathe for a day and a half. The next day I went in there, I took a whiff. And they smelt like Hip Hop Magoo. You understand me? Fresh as a fucking. And you know why? Because of me on these special material called Modar. But listen, this Valentine's Day, give a gift that they can unwrap again and again. Matching underwear from me on these. Who's better than you? Valentine's Day, it's near, and it's go-to time for the thoughtful gift hunting. Me on these has covered you with limited edition matching pairs of undies for you and yours. Has Valentine's Day got you stumped? Forget the cliches and give a gift that looks great, feels great, and will make everybody happy. MeUndies. You ever give a girl a pair of underwear? You knock them right off their fucking horse. You understand me? The only thing is make sure the size is right. Because if you give them a big pair, they're going to smack you right in the face. And you're in no danger getting a fucking hand job. You understand me? Fancy dinners, chocolate last night, flowers last week. Fancy dinners, chocolate last a night, and flowers last a week. This year, give the gift of looking great and feeling great. Every day with the world's most comfortable underwear. MeUndies, all right? MeUndies are the perfect gift for you and yours this holiday. They're unbelievably soft and come in limited edition prints. MeUndies knows that your special someone deserves a special fabric, which is why their underwear is made with exclusively of out of Modal, like I told you, a fabric with a touch three times softer than cotton. MeUndies is special, limited edition Valentine's undie, which means you and your Valentine can match. And yeah, it's as cute as it sounds. You understand me? Not for me. Women like that shit. When you show up, shit, we're matching. If you want your balls licked, something's got to match. You know what I'm saying? And if for some reason you and MeUndies aren't a perfect match, they'll give you your money back and let you keep your first pair. There's no refund on a bad fancy dinner, all right? They offer free shipping and for limited time, listeners to this podcast get 20% off their first order. But you got to go to MeUndies.com/Joey's. With the MeUndies Better Day Guarantee, you have nothing to lose. Ugats. So don't wait any longer. Go to MeUndies right now. Go to MeUndies.com/Joey right now and get 20% off your first order. Get the matching Valentines. Get the red with the fucking black polka dots. She's going to love it. She fuck the flowers, hit her with the underwear. The one she's got on, you rip them off, you throw her on the floor, you eat that monkey, and then you put the new pair on, you say, Happy Valentine's Day, honey. I love you. This is we've been together 10 years. Your monkey's never tasted so delicious. You understand me?
Man, and that's because you got
MeUndies on. Again, go to MeUndies.com right now, /Joey, and get 20% off your first order and free shipping. Who's better than you, cocksuckers? All right, here we go. Let me ask you people something. Are you hiring? Do you know where to post your job to find the best candidates? Posting your job in one place isn't enough to find quality candidates. If you want to find the perfect hire, you need to post your job on all the top job sites, and now you can. You ready? With ZipRecruiter.com, you can post your job to 200-plus job sites, including social media networks like Facebook and Twitter. You ready for this one? With a single click. Find candidates in any city or industry nationwide. Just post one time and watch your qualified candidates roll into ZipRecruiter's easy-to-use interface. No juggling emails, no calls to your office. Quickly screen candidates, you rate them, and you hire the right person. Boom, fast. Find out today why ZipRecruiter has been used by Fortune 100 companies and thousands of small and medium-sized businesses. And right now, my listeners can post jobs on ZipRecruiter for free by going to ZipRecruiter.com/church. Again, ZipRecruiter.com/church. That's ZipRecruiter.com/church. One more time. That's ZipRecruiter.com/church. All right, do me a favor. Go post jobs on ZipRecruiter right now for free. I want to thank Onnit. I want to thank MeUndies. And I want to thank ZipRecruiter. But most of all, I want to thank my brother, Ralphie May, for stopping in.
Thank you so much, Coco.
You know, I hope you guys support
it. It's a pleasure, man.
Listen, man, if you haven't gone to Vegas, I'll tell you what. You look at his calendar. You pick a date. You go on the hotel thing. Lee will fucking help you. You pick a cheap fucking hotel. Whatever you need to do to get there. You know, from time to time, you deserve a break. They got great deals in Vegas. They got fucking great deals if you look for those things.
Harrah's is a really, it's a nice hotel that's reasonable. And the thing I like about Harrah's is it's right on that rail line. I think I'm almost positive, even in Harrah's.
Yeah.
So that means the MGM, it's connected to the entire strip.
You go for a couple of days, you see Ralphie, you get a massage, you take your wife, you come on her titties, you know how it is. You get a nice fucking dinner. Who gives a fuck? You only live once. Like I said, Ralph, you'll be there how many weeks?
Coco, it's going to be 28 weeks this year. Right. And
this is what I'm talking about, people. And, you got 28 fucking weeks to fly in and make a weekend of it, all right?
You church people, y'all come up to me. You tell me you're part of the church of what's happening now. And guess what? We're taking pictures and hanging out. I'm probably hitting you up for a number. All right, so don't come empty-handed, Jack. Let's go.
I love you motherfuckers. Don't forget, I'm in Nashville next week.
Fuck yes.
And I don't know what's going to happen with the Flappers thing for the taping for the cat special, because they put me on the Gong Show by mistake. So I don't even know if we're doing that tonight, but I'll tweet and you come on Thursday night, all right? And that's basically it. Ralphie starts where this weekend?
I'll be in Harrah's in Las Vegas, right there on the strip.
What's Coco? The
date? Thursday, what? The 26th, Thursday the 26th, Friday the 27th, and Saturday the 28th at 10 o'clock.
Best January 29th was my first pinch, 1982.
No, really?
January 1983, I got pinched.
Was that the jewelry job?
Nah, possession of some tools and shit. Mr. Holloway bailed me out.
Yeah.
You know how we do. What's up, Lee Syatt? You going through changes again?
I am.
You know why?
Why?
Because you don't train correctly.
I did. Oh, my God.
You're fucking lying.
The reason why I'm bugging out is because Ralphie said that they give you chips when you go. That's like my dream.
Where?
At Harrah's.
Harrah's, yeah. Well, you come, Lee. You're going to be part of church weekend.
Ralphie, I'll be there every day.
We'll see if we can get Coco to go out there, and maybe we'll make a big thing of it. Me, you, bring the girls if they want to come. I get spas, so I'll send Terry to the spa like a doctor. All right? We'll go down there and get massages and get steams and shit like that. That's the best. It was better than you. All right? And we do that, and we go to Vegas having fun. We bring some church people in. You know? My man Darren Noble wants to come out. Those fools. Dude, all my friends are out watching us right now. My Twitter's blowing up.
Oh, shit.
They love us. I love them. They can't do nothing about it. I love
these people, too.
I know. It's like Coco, you know, it's like, if we can't fucking have fun with our fans that are friends of ours, what the fuck are we doing this for, you know? It's like you see those comics who try to big time everybody. It's like, what the fuck are you doing, man? These are the people that love you, that pay your fucking bills.
It's a fucking nightmare.
Right? Fucking nightmares.
It's like a jungle sometimes. It makes you wonder how I keep from going under. Hit it, Lee.
Come on.
I love you, motherfucker. Stay black. And don't forget Uncle Joey, Ralphie May, and Lee Syatt. I love you. We'll see you motherfuckers Wednesday night, same bat time, same bat channel.